presented by Remington. As we come your way from Morgantown, West Virginia, an atypically beautiful late November afternoon, as number 7 West Virginia takes on the South Florida Bulls, who are bowl eligible for the second consecutive season and the second time in their histories. The Big East standings, there is a three-way tie atop them. West Virginia can still win the Big East and the BCS bowl bid that goes with it. They would have to win today and next week over Rutgers and have Louisville lose one of its remaining games, either today against Pittsburgh or next week against Connecticut. And welcome to Morgantown, Pam Ward, along with Bill Curry, who is in this week for Mike Gottfried. And when you look at this West Virginia team, you have Steve Slayton and Pat White. Safe to say, the most exciting running back quarterback combination in the country.
Safe to say for me, the most productive tandem on offense I've ever seen in football. Pam, they've only gained 4,280 yards this year. That is 2.43 miles of real estate on the football field. 33 touchdowns between them, 16 and 17 respectively. They are quite simply unstoppable. Nobody has figured out a way to slow these guys down.
Boy, and Pittsburgh certainly did not slow them down a week ago. Both of them ran for over 200 yards apiece. Now, for South Florida, they have a very exciting redshirt freshman in Matt Grothy, who can hurt you in a lot of ways.
Matt Grothy is a gifted young man. He leads the nation for freshman quarterbacks in several categories, but that's not his most important statistic. The best thing he's done is to lead his team from behind 5 times to win this year and very nearly pulled off 2 others. He has enormous presence for a young man his age. He can catch the ball. He's even caught passes this year. He can punt the ball. He runs extremely well. And as you see, he throws very well.
So Rich Rodriguez and his defensive staff game planning to try to stop Grothy. Rodriguez was a walk-on football player here and now has done tremendous things. One of the most innovative offenses that a lot of other people have borrowed from across the country. And Jim Leavitt started with this program when it was born 10 seasons ago, and they went to a bowl last year. They are bowl eligible once again. He also has done a fabulous job building that program from the ground up. And speaking of fabulous, it doesn't get any better than this in West Virginia in late November.
Yeah, this is more fabulous.
Oh, my goodness. And we are expecting temperatures actually to climb into the mid-60s. West Virginia won the toss and deferred, so South Florida will receive. It is a short kickoff taken at the 14-yard line by Trey Williams. And Williams, who is a starting cornerback, gets it out to about the 22-yard line on a 9-yard return. We just talked about him, Matt Grothy, the redshirt freshman quarterback from Lakeland, Florida, number 2 in the Big East in total offense. But no freshman quarterback in the country has put up numbers like this. And he leads this South Florida team. They are coming off a 31-8 loss to mighty Louisville last week. Grothy was actually sacked 6 times in that game, and we expect West Virginia to come after him. Hand off to Benjamin Williams. Williams is the walk-on who still does not have a scholarship, and he gets 4 yards on first down. Impact players for the South Florida Bulls offense. Ian Randolph, their leading receiver, very dangerous in space, and Marcus Edwards, more of a possession receiver in South Florida's spread offense. Their leading rusher, though, happens to be their quarterback, Grothy. Now on 2nd and 6, here he goes. His first carry, and he slips down on the Astro play turf and loses 4 yards. So a 3rd and long coming up for the Bulls. Look at the rest of Florida, or South Florida's offense. Again, they run the spread. They've had a lot of shakeups on their offensive line. Thed Watson, their starting left tackle, dismissed from the team a couple of weeks ago. So Mark Dial has moved over in that spot, and here they are now facing a 3rd and 10. Is complete for the first down. Taurus Johnson, they needed 10 and they got 13. Of Johnson, who was the fastest player on this team, and that's a big first down.
This is exactly what you have to love about Grothy. Not a good start First series, not going well. He slips and falls down, can't keep his feet. He just stands in there, takes the snap, finds the open receiver, hits Torrace Jackson for the first down. And this is the way he plays all the time. He has enormous poise for a young man his age.
And that really, when we talked to the coaches during the week, that's all they kept talking about. For a redshirt freshman, it's amazing the poise, the maturity, and the decisions he makes. And that's a big-time hit. Benjamin Williams smacked down by Quentin Andrews, but he still picked up 5 yards. This West Virginia defense, the best rushing defense in the Big East. Johnny Dingle, big defensive end Eric Wicks at safety, and Kevin Boo McClee, a talented linebacker who leads the team in tackles. Again, we expect them to go after Grothy and put some pressure on this redshirt freshman who now works in the empty backfield. Second and 5. He steps in. It's intercepted. He threw it right to Eric Wicks. And Wicks, whose nickname in high school was Wicks for 6, doesn't quite get into the end zone, but it'll be first and goal for the Mountaineers.
I couldn't tell whether the ball was tipped or not. But regardless of whether it was or not, Wicks is the big play guy on this defense. It looks like the ball was deflected. You can see that Warren Young, number 90, got up. But Wicks was already in position. He might have picked the thing anyhow. He made a nice play on the football to put it away because it was actually a little bit behind him as he broke.
It's the third interception of the season for Eric Wicks, and if there's one knock on Grothy, it's the interception to touchdown ratio. Now 13 touchdown passes and 12, or make that 13 interceptions. That was a 32-yard return for Wicks, and here come the Mountaineers. And right away, Steve Slayton gets the ball and picks up a couple.
The most important statistic in this game is 7.2 yards per carry running the ball by West Virginia versus 2.7 per yard per carry that their defense gives up. Now, they didn't look like it on that play, but they run the ball so very well.
And South Florida's defense has been a good rushing defense, giving up only about 3.4 yards per carry. Patrick White, the running quarterback, gets it down to the 5-yard line, where it will be third and goal. West Virginia impact players, nobody has a bigger impact than the quarterbacks, Pat White, and the running back, Steve Slayton. But two of the guys who open up things, Bill Curry loves it when we talk about centers. Dan Moses is one of the best, and Owen Schmidt's the big fullback.
Yeah, both those guys are terrific players, but Moses is too good looking to be a center.
And he's very fussy about his hair, too.
Yes, yeah, he's a very attractive guy.
As Shelley Poe, their sports information director, tells us, actually, this is third and 4. They can get a first down without scoring a touchdown. Pat White goes nowhere, so a good job by that South Florida defense. Pat St. Louis, one of their talented linebackers, in on the stop.
It's a great stop. This is a great series for the South Florida. This is something I should have brought up earlier. If these guys could get a stop down here, it'd be very, very rare. Since Patrick White took over as quarterback, West Virginia has scored in the red zone 32 out of 33 times, 21 touchdowns, and they have forced South Florida, the defense, has forced a field goal attempt here, assuming West Virginia tries the kick.
And Pat McAfee is out to do just that, but they fake it. The ball is faked and then fumbled at the end. Travis McClintock, the holder, fumbled it. And South Florida, no matter who recovered it, should get the ball here on downs. They did not get it down to the 1-yard line, which was where they needed to get. So how about that call by Rich Rodriguez?
Well, the reason I said assuming that they kicked this ball is because I got a funny little feeling when they came out that Rich was not going to want to settle for a field goal here. Another great job by the swarming linebacker, Stephen Nicholas, who is the main man on defense for the University of South Florida. They call him the snake because he just slithers around, according to his coaches. Gets off blockers and makes hits.
6 in the Big East in tackles, and he already has 3 today after one offensive series. So South Florida pinned back, 1st and 10 from the 3. Ricky Ponton, the sophomore from Tampa, who has one 100-yard game this season, gets the first carry after he picked up 3 yards. Here now is a look at this West Virginia defense as they will try to stop South Florida. West Virginia first in the Big East in rushing defense, total yards per game. They have not allowed a 100-yard rusher all season. And you would figure with South Florida that should stay the same. Grothy, nowhere to go but down as he is enveloped by Warren Young.
One thing that West Virginia is going to do today, and I'm not talking about dirty play, I'm talking about physical play, they're going to try to punish Grothy. They're going to try to get blitzers in his face when he throws, and they're going to gang tackle him on defense. They do not want him to make the difference in this game as he has so very often this year.
And you see they have not allowed a 100-yard rusher and now face a third and five showing blitz. Gets it off, but that is going to be well short of, or very close to the first down. Check that as he was marked close to the first down marker. That's Ian Randolph. Randolph, very dangerous wide receiver, leads them in catches and also is a great punt returner.
Don't you love the way the offensive linemen come up and help the officials on calls like this? And the officials really appreciate it. Yeah. The linemen are sure, hey, that's a first down, man.
Did you ever do that when you played?
Never.
Never.
Wouldn't dare. I was too tired. I was trying to find the place to set up the huddle. I didn't have the energy to help the official. I'm going to say this again and again, and Grothy really impresses me. He's throwing the ball near his end zone. That's two little hook patterns he's hit for first downs. That is not easy to do. There are a lot of hands in his face, a lot of blitzers after him big time. He's supposed to be intimidated by this environment. Not a chance. I really like him.
Yeah, boy, he's tough. He's been starting since the second week of the season. Pat Julmus, who was the starting quarterback last year, went out with an injury, and it has been Grothy's show ever since. So they do get the first down, and Grothy's looking to throw again. And that one is nicely placed between two defenders into the arms of Cedric Hill, 15 yards and another first down for the Bulls.
We'll take a look at his motion. He's not 6'4". He does not throw BBs. He doesn't have what we call a gun for an arm. He just delivers on rhythm, and it is his rhythm. The ball comes out so quickly, he doesn't have to have that rocket velocity to complete passes.
Now they go to the ground on first down. That is, it is carried by Ponton, and he picks up five.
Ponton has a little burst. His coaches talk about him in terms of talent and potential, and potential means you haven't really done it yet. But he had a nice little burst there and got about halfway to the first down.
Matt Grothy first in two very major categories among freshman quarterbacks and third in passing yards. And now facing a second and five. Three receivers to his right, two to his left. Plenty of time, and he goes over the middle and completes it for yet another first down. Once again, it's Ian Randolph for a dozen more yards. So South Florida, this makeshift offensive line has done a good job of giving Grothy enough time to find his receivers.
Makeshift it is, and they're holding up very well against these blitzers. But watch him as he sets up in the pocket here, and we'll see where the ball is actually delivered. He doesn't come straight over the top. The ball is about a three-quarter delivery. He doesn't throw it very hard. I'm saying this again, but he gets it where he wants to.
As Ponton gets it and is dropped for a one-yard loss. Grothy so far on this drive is perfect for 3 for 3 for 33 yards, starting since the second game of the season. And Bill mentioned it in the open. He has engineered 5 come-from-behind victories, which is incredible, really. Very good for any quarterback. We're talking about a redshirt freshman here.
Almost did it against Kansas and Rutgers as well, which would be 7 in a season.
And now facing a second and 11. Grothy takes it himself and picks up a couple as we get our first update of the day from Linda Cohn.
All right, Pam, this update presented by Taco Bell. Game on ESPN. Big rivalry game. Clemson hosting South Carolina. Quarterback Will Proctor, short pass to Jacoby Ford, the freshman, and he does the rest. A second career receiving touchdown for Ford. Clemson looking to beat South Carolina for the 5th straight time. They haven't done that since the mid to late 1930s at 7-0 Clemson.
So the battle in Clemson, South Carolina, and the Tigers are up on that one, the battle of the state of South Carolina. Here we have a 3rd and 10 for the Bulls. And Grothy, a lot of time again. Finally, he is dropped. Sacked by Reed Williams, the sophomore from Moorfield, West Virginia. But boy, that was, he had a lot of time to throw, but great coverage downfield by the West Virginia secondary.
Again, really good protection. Really good time. Stands in there. And again, a big mistake that freshman quarterbacks so often make is to try to force the ball in there. It's better to take the sack and live to fight another day.
5th sack of the season for Reed Williams. Antonio Lewis waits on the 20. For the punt. And he is dropped down just a couple of yards. He catches it by Devin Gordon. So we still have a scoreless game in Morgantown. Steve Slayton, one of the best there is, coming on the field when we return. This telecast is available on ESPN2 HD, presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. And it is a beautiful day to roll down a hill and watch a football game here in mountainous West Virginia. But so far, the Mountaineers have been kept off the scoreboard. They had a golden opportunity last time they had the ball. First down from the 11, but were unable to score. Their fake field goal didn't work. And now they are on the 23. Pat White, the running quarterback, picks up a couple as he is stopped by Ben Moffitt. Let's go down to the third member of our team, Dave Ryan.
All right, Pam, the numbers for Pat White of West Virginia, nothing short of phenomenal. He has 14-1 his career as a starting quarterback, and entering the Navy does just 32 rushing yards to become the all-time leading rusher for quarterbacks in Big East Conference history. And after the play, Pam will tell you more about the incredible career of Pat White.
And he is only a sophomore, Rhino, and that's amazing. He's going to be setting career rushing records as a quarterback in only his second year. And then the other guy who does all the damage is Steve Slayton.
So hard to imagine, guys, that it wasn't until week 8, replacing Adam Bednarik, that Pat White actually took over as a starting quarterback last year. And Pam, I don't want to date myself too much, but in 1989, right out of Syracuse University, my first job, could it be that long ago, was covering West Virginia football, and a guy named Major Harris, who led his team to the national championship game, they lost Notre Dame that year. But right now, people here in West Virginia are comparing Pat White to Major Harris.
Major Harris was a guy who got them all the way to a national title game, and Pat White has been spectacular as a starter for only a season and a third, and that is a conversion for the first down to Darius Raymond, who picks up 9 in the first down. Let's get back to Linda Cohn.
Welcome to the Nerve Center of College Football. I'm Linda Cohn. A game West Virginia Mountaineer fans are very much interested. Yeah, I'm talking about the Rutgers Scarlet Knights playing on ESPNU right now, and they're playing Syracuse. Remember, next week West Virginia plays Rutgers, and the lethal weapon, Ray Rice, his 17th rushing touchdown, puts Rutgers on the board first.
Ray Rice, one of the best there is, and Rutgers will be here next week to take on West Virginia as Slayton gets the carry, picks up 7 more yards. That last first down was the first down of the game for the Mountaineers.
And Slayton's run was the first time they've been able to penetrate this South Florida defense for anything over a yard or two. They've been really stout up front. The best I've seen West Virginia defense in the early going this year.
They have averaged 44 points a game in their home games this season. They average about 41 points a game overall. That is second in the country. And that pass is completed out to Brandon Miles out in the flat, but he doesn't get anything. In fact, will lose a yard as Miles is tackled down by George Selvey, one of the defensive ends, the most productive of the front four guys.
One of the really important things that the Bulls did coming off their goal line is to change the field position. They did not give West Virginia the ball in very good field position, and West Virginia's got a long drive ahead of it.
Yep, in fact, they did start back at the 23, and now it's 3rd and 4. From the 45. And White fakes it to Slayton. Looking up top, he has his man, and that's a perfectly thrown ball for the first down to Darius Raynaud. So a nice 3rd and 4 completion. completion goes for 23 yards.
Really nice pass protection. This is not what you hear about with this West Virginia team. You hear about their rushing. Good protection and a nice four vertical route against the two deep. And Renard coming across the middle. White makes a perfect throw right over the top, takes the hit, showing a lot of courage, which all great quarterbacks have to have.
It was Richard Kleebert, a 310-pounder who hit Pat White, who's listed at about 185. And Mr. Slayton takes it on the left side, picks up about four more yards. He is coming off a monstrous game last week against Pittsburgh. In that game, he had 215 yards rushing, 130 yards receiving, 345 total yards, and now second in the all-time single-season rushing marks. He's gone by Famous Amos and now is going after Avon Coburn, an exceptional running back. The story has been well told that the University of Maryland recruited him and rescinded its scholarship offer. And Maryland's loss has certainly been West Virginia's gain.
Wouldn't that make you feel good?
Oh. Second and five. Pat White right up the middle. And lightning quick, he picks up another first down. That's 10 yards. Chris Robinson finally makes the stop.
One of the things that you don't hear a lot about with any quarterbacks these days is ball handling. The ball literally disappears for the linebackers. That's prestidigitation, sleight of hand. You make the ball disappear, and suddenly you got a place to run. You're looking funny, Pam.
Presto what?
Prestidigitation, sleight of hand.
Okay, we'll go with sleight of hand. That's a good word. That's a six-syllable word. That's good. First and 10 here for the Mountaineers after prestidigitation. Steve Slayton going inside and picking up six more yards. His offensive line, Dan Moses is the center, the senior from Washington, Pennsylvania. And he is an Outland Trophy finalist along with Justin Blaylock and Joe Thomas. And boy, he's opening up a nice hole.
This has no sleight of hand. There's nothing fancy about this. The entire left side of the South Florida defensive line was caved in by Dan Moses, Jeremy Sheffy, and Jake Figner. Good job by the big guys for West Virginia.
Sheffy's a senior at 295. He is the right guard next to Moses. Now, West Virginia on the move. 10th play. Down as Patrick White steps out just short of the goal line, but a flag has been dropped around the 12-yard line.
Looks like they're going to call, this usually call on the end guy on the line of scrimmage when it comes from out there. That would be Ryan Stanchek, number 62. These are the kinds of things that Rich Rodriguez just hates. He's got the guy hooked. You got the guy hooked, Ryan. He's coming inside you. He's not going to make the play. Why would you grab cloth, son? That's some of what Ryan will hear, along with some other things, yes, when they get in the team meetings.
Right. Stanchek, the sophomore from Cincinnati, grabbing a hold of George Selvey. So instead of a first and goal from inside the one, it's now a second and 15 from the 22.
Now, everything that can happen to keep South Florida encouraged in the early part of this game is happening. They stopped them on downs. They drove the ball, punted the ball into good field position for them, made West Virginia drive the length of the field. Now they got a chance to stop them again.
We saw West Virginia, the most penalized team in the country, now officially second and 14 from the 21. And White tries to take off, but that's a great from Josh Jonas, the sophomore from Miramar, Florida, and the brother of the former starting quarterback, drops him for a one-yard loss.
Nice play by Josh Jonas. And to use his coach's phrases, and I'm quoting his coaches, he was suspended the first six games. We are waiting for Josh to play well. Well, coach, you just got your wish. Nice play by Josh Jonas.
They say they need him to play better, and that was a great play. And that makes it third and 15 for the Mountaineers. And White goes underneath. The man who cleared is Darrell Jallo. And Jallo is marked close to the first down. Mike Jenkins finally ran him down. And it looks like they are going to mark it just a little bit short as the first quarter to a close. Rich Rodriguez has already had one trick play off his sleeve. We'll see if he has another one when we come back.
ESPN2's College Football is presented by Pennzoil. Not just oil, Pennzoil. And in part by Remington Titanium Shavers. And ESPN Game Plan, Maximum College Football. To order, call your pay-per-view provider or log on to ESPN.com, search Game Plan.
Beautiful view, the Monongahela River that runs around Morgantown, and they are going for it, everybody, on fourth and one. A couple of fullbacks behind the quarterback, Pat White. And flags are down. There's movement in the middle of the line as White held on to it. A little surprised they're going for it here, Coach?
Well, it's less than a yard. If I'm Rich Rodriguez, they're going to call us on
5-yard penalty.
Well, they'll kick it now.
Fourth down.
Wow.
The most penalized team.
You don't want to be in the team meeting when these tapes are watched. Rich Rodriguez is going to be very, very unhappy. And I don't see anybody moving across there in a blue shirt. Now, the official obviously did. And those guys are right there on the spot. And they're very seldom wrong on these things. I did not see the kind of movement that should have prompted a penalty. Got a player down.
Yeah, that is Patrick St. Louis. He hurt his hamstring in last week's loss against Louisville. And he is down again. A very productive linebacker. The linebacker is certainly the strength of this defense with Nicholas Moffitt and St. Louis.
All of them run under 4-6, and they really, really tackle well.
All right, so it's fourth and six now. We anticipate a field goal attempt as St. Louis is helped to his feet. When we come back to Morgantown. Welcome back to Morgantown. Pat McAfee in to try a 30-yard field goal. Made a 51-yarder last week up in Heinz Field. The longest in the history of that stadium, either by a pro or a collegiate player. So after the penalty, they're going for it on fourth and one. Now fourth and six, they're going to go for the field goal.
Tough angle for a right-footed kicker. Just a little thing to be watching.
McAfee plays the angle perfectly, and West Virginia strikes first. So South Florida doing a good job so far defensively. Rich Rodriguez's team up 3-0. Matt Grothy, the best freshman quarterback going, is on the field. Welcome back to Morgantown, West Virginia. The Mountaineers with just one loss on the season, losing to Louisville a couple of weeks ago. They are up 3-0 on Matt Grothy and company. As Grothy, the redshirt freshman quarterback, heading back to the field. Both of these teams heading for bowls. We have heard the Birmingham Bowl is a big possibility for South Florida. They made it to a bowl game last year and ended up losing to NC State. This program certainly on the rise, and West Virginia waits to finish its regular season next week against Rutgers. Trey Williams gets the kickoff around his 14. Good coverage by the West Virginia special teams as he has dropped down around the 20. We get another update now from Linda Cohn.
Over on ESPN, South Carolina and Clemson, after Blake Mitchell totted up with a rushing TD, C.J. Spiller explodes. An 80-yard touchdown run for Clemson. Spiller's ninth rushing touchdown this year. He's a freshman, you know. 14-7 Clemson at home beating South Carolina. And the battle for the victory belt, Duke beating North Carolina 10-7 as Duke is looking to avoid its fourth winless season since 96.
Wow, another tough year for Duke. North Carolina, the last game for John Bunting, their head coach. One of the several changes that have been, and certainly expect some more in the coaching ranks. On first down, the ball is given to Benjamin Williams, who picks up 3 yards.
The early impression in this game, West Virginia normally comes out smoking and destroys people in the first quarter. Did not do that at all. I think they're just a little bit lackadaisical. I think their coaches are going to be in their face over there on that sideline and try to get them motivated. You do not look like the normal quickness with the kind of zip that they normally display.
They are 3 touchdown favorites in this game. And then that big game next week when Rutgers comes to town. 2nd and 7, Grothy, as they pick up the blitz very nicely. And Grothy floats one perfectly into the arm arms of Amari Jackson, this junior from Sarasota, Florida. And Grothy that time just planted it right in there. 39-yard gain.
Great blitz pickup. Good gracious. Watch number 30, Benjamin Williams, right there. That's the way you pick up a blitzer. Just like that. Nice throw and catch. That was Ridwan Malik that was blitzing. And a perfect throw. And you'll see this young man do it again and again. Amari Jackson on the other end. Right over the right outside shoulder. Nobody else had a chance to catch that ball.
Get it all the way down to the 38 of West Virginia. And they only pick up a couple as Williams gets the ball once again. Quentin Andrews making the stop.
Now, Pam, I'm going to make a prediction. Mm-hmm. Benjamin Williams is going to get a scholarship pretty soon if he keeps picking up blitzers. Because when you pick up a blitzer, it ought to look like a pickup truck hitting a chicken. And that's exactly what that looked like. Feathers flying everywhere. Boom! And you get it where that guy doesn't want to run in there anymore.
Boy, Williams is a sophomore and still does not have a scholarship and is now the starting tailback. And the coaches talk about how good he is in the blocking game and picking up blitzes, and he did just that as that ball is dropped. Boy, Marcus Edwards had it hit him right in the hands, and he couldn't bring it in.
Hit him in a bad place. That's one thing. These guys have done a nice job of catching the ball for this young quarterback, and that has to continue. Watch his eyes. Watch Marcus's eyes. He's already turning to look upfield to see who he's going to beat instead of looking at the tip of that football and bringing it in.
So with the drop, it's now 3rd and 8. Fans getting into it a little bit. All the tickets distributed, but many students have not returned from Thanksgiving break, so it's not jammed full as we're used to seeing. 3rd and 8 for the Bulls. A lot of pressure, and Grothy for the second time today goes down. Sacked around the 49-yard line by Eric Wicks, the senior from Pittsburgh, the leader of the defensive secondary.
Now, this is a different sack from the first one. The first one was a covered sack. This is a scheme sack because Wick is clean. They got one more rusher than the blockers were to block. And another big play by Eric Wicks, his second of the day.
He has an interception and now the sack, his 7th of the season, as Justin Tichy is in for his second punt. Antonio Lewis, the deep man, back at the 11.
And the coaches put it right on Mr. Wicks. They said, this guy has got to play well in this game for us.
Tichy, directional punting, trying to get it into the coffin corner, but it scooches into the end zone. 46-yard punt, but only a 26-yard net as West Virginia will start from the 20. Eric Wicks from Pittsburgh coming up with the big sack. West Virginia has the ball when we return. Welcome back to Morgantown. 3-0 West Virginia over South Florida. Our Aflac trivia question. Last week, Pat White became the 8th player in NCAA history to rush and pass for 200 yards in a single game. We want to know if you can name even one of the other 7 guys who did that. Give you a little bit of time to ponder that one, but Pat White was absolutely brilliant last week in the backyard brawl. 220 yards rushing, 204 passing in the 45-27 win for the Mountaineers. But here they're only up 3-0 on South Florida as they try to get this great running game going, and nothing doing for Slayton, who is stopped for no gain. Pat, St. Louis not on the field for South Florida. Dave Ryan has more on his injury.
Yeah, Pam, bad news from here on the South Florida sideline. Pat St. Louis, you talked about, very popular player, star linebacker. The teammates gathered around him to see how he's doing. Give him a pat on the shoulder. Sprained right knee. He's been iced. He's been taken off the field, as you saw, on a cart, and it looks like he's done for the day, Pam.
Well, that really is a shame. As Dave mentioned, he's such an integral part of that defense. The linebackers are the strength of it. On 2nd and 10, Pat White. This is what he can do. He can make trouble disappear and then get a big gain as White is able to get away from the defenders and pick up 9 yards. Ben Moffitt among those pursuing him.
This is what happens when you're not on your game the way you should be. Instead of having excellent protection, you let people run clean on your quarterback. That was Richard Kleber, who wasn't quite quick enough to get the fleet quarterback, but it's not your normal. But West Virginia is not clicking on all cylinders.
Facing a 3rd and 1, White keeps it, gets the first down. Out past past the 31-yard line. George Selvey making the stop.
First quarter statistics. West Virginia averaging 4 yards per carry. A lot of teams would consider that just fine, but they're accustomed to averaging 7.2 yards per carry. And Steve Slayton, the superback, is accustomed to 7.7 yards per carry, and he hadn't made an inch today.
Well, he had 7 yards of rushing in the first half last week against Pittsburgh and then really got going. And so far, he is 25 yards on the ground. And off the reverse, here comes Darius Reynaud. A lot of green in front of him. He makes the cutback and is finally chased down. A good job by Mike Jenkins not to quit on the play. But Reynaud gets it all the way down, close to the 10-yard line.
When you got a fast-flow defense like the University of South Florida, especially with them playing inspired football today, then you get them all going in the wrong direction. And then you come back the other way with Reynaud, who does a nice job of turning on down the sideline. Doesn't have great speed, but adequate speed to get it down inside the 15.
And that is a 57-yard gain, so it is first and 10 from the 11. And Steve Slayton, who had all sorts of trouble in last year's game against South Florida, loses 6 yards as Chris Robinson got him. In fact, last year against South Florida, he averaged only 3.1 yards per carry. That is a career low for him. And one of only 2 games in his last 14 in which he has not cracked the 100-yard mark, and they've done a good job on Slayton so far today.
They've smothered him today, but wouldn't it be nice if your worst day was an 86-yard day?
Yeah, that's really, really feel sorry for him. And there you see the numbers. Third fewest in his career, and again, 3.1 yards per carry, the worst of his career. 6-yard loss on that play. So White goes up top. Quick hitter to Reynaud. And he goes down inside the 15-yard line. Here's Linda Cohn with another update. Linda.
On ABC, Pam, Florida, Florida State, the Seminoles enter this game unranked for the first time since 86. Chris Leak, the screen pass. That'll work to Andre Caldwell for his second touchdown this season. For Leak, his 20th touchdown this season. Gators need a huge win to stay in this national title hunt. They need to pull on the points, Pam.
And they're going to need some help to do that as well. Thank you, Linda. Florida up in that battle of the state of Florida. Third and 14, Pat White runs right into Josh Jolmes. That's the first time that he has not completed a pass. White had been 5 for 5 on the day, but Jolmes got in there and knocked it down.
South Florida is playing inspired football right now, and West Virginia simply isn't. I'm not saying that this is White's fault, because certainly a nice play by Jolmes to get his hands up and time that thing. And again, his coaches have emphasized what a good athlete he is and how he has sort of rested on his laurels up until this point. Not so today.
Well, he's had a couple of big plays today as Josh, including that knockdown as he was looking, White was, for Slayton out in the flat. 33-yard field goal attempt for Pat McAfee. He hit already. So West Virginia settling for a pair of field goals so far today as they lead South Florida 6-0. But the big play in this drive, a 57-yard run on this reverse by Darius Reynaud. West Virginia up by 2 field goals.
ESPN2's College Football, brought to you by Dodge. You can take life as it comes, or you can grab life by the horns. Dodge. And Aflac. Ask about it at work.
That is the view you get from the Morgantown Personal Rapid Transit System that runs around campus and all around Morgantown. It's an automated system. Campus rather quiet this weekend. Many of the students still not coming back yet from their Thanksgiving break, but it's always a great place to see a football game. And right now, the locals probably a little disappointed, I safe to say, in being down 6-0. Short kickoff fielded by one of the up men at the 22-yard line. And South Florida will start from the 37 after a 14-yard return by Christopher Ellick, the backup defensive back for the Bulls. Pat White last week became the eighth player in NCAA history to rush and pass for 200 yards in a game. Our Aflac trivia question, can you name one of the other seven to do it? And there they are. If you guessed one of these guys, you are correct. Vince Young, of course, great Texas quarterback, Reds Bagnell. Tell me about him, Coach.
Did you pick Reds Bagnell, Pam?
Well, who didn't?
I thought Elway would be one.
On the move, a completed pass to Devin Gordon as Grothy is able to pick up close to 9 yards on that play. Pat White, his counterpart, talking to his receivers on the sidelines. And Red's back now. You want to know about Red? You get the ESPN College Football Encyclopedia. It's large, it's heavy, but it's heavy with information.
It's wonderful.
Well.
It's wonderful. If you love sports stats, and I do, you go look at that thing every week or two if you've got one. And I just love mine.
Holiday season fast approaching. Ricky Ponton fails to pick up the first down on second and very short.
You can find Red's Bagnell in there. You can find everything that he did, and you can find everything that Red Grange did. You can find everything that Walter Payton did. It's just fascinating. It really is.
And Bill Curry is in there, of course.
You cannot find Bill Curry because all I did was hike the ball and stay alive for 20 years.
But that was you made a pretty good living out of that.
My job was to hike the ball and be run over slowly.
Yeah. So you were, it's hard to believe looking at you now that you were a center. You're so thin. And
it was hard to believe then. My teammates used to marvel. Look, is that our center? Can't we find, Coach, could we get somebody better than Bill? It was a little joke that we had.
And they're that short. Dave Ryan is close to the West Virginia bench. Rhino?
Well, Pam, we all have to keep in mind here that WVU is still playing for a possibility of getting to a BCS game. They're a top 10 team. They could win the Big East Conference this year, and there is very little to no energy on the sideline right now. The offense has not done a whole lot, as you mentioned, only a 6-0 lead, which seems to be very disappointing to this team. And Rich Rodriguez told us this week, what we really need to do is focus and realize there's a lot on the line here. Hey, 10 days off between their last game with Pittsburgh and today here for the Mountaineers. Maybe a little bit flat. Sure feels like it down here.
Thanks, Rhino. Of course, they have Rutgers here next week. So it is sort of set up to be somewhat of a letdown game. This would be a big stop on third and inches. Grothy hanging on to it.
He got it. He is a gritty competitor. They didn't get much movement. The West Virginia D-line did a nice job of getting up underneath their offensive lineman of South Florida. But Grothy is just a scrappy, move those feet. And he ran a quarterback sneak the way you're supposed to run. This is how you're supposed to do a sneak. You get your pads down. You get right behind that big rear end of your center, if it's as big as that, which is good. For some of us, it wasn't.
Nick Capone.
Capone did a nice job. Yeah, Nick got knocked back and then moved his feet and did a good job to help out.
5 rush yards, a couple of sacks figured in against Grothy. That's a long ball that is picked off. The second one that Grothy has thrown today. This time, Quentin Andrews gets in the way as the receiver downfield was double covered. And Andrews, Johnson double covered, and Andrews made a pay for it with the pick.
Rod Smith and Jim Leavitt, the offensive coordinator and head coach respectively, said this young guy has got to just take care of the football and not make big mistakes. You throw the ball late, deep, down the middle, somebody like Quentin Andrews will always be there to take it away from you. He never looked at the free safety. He's only looking at Torres Johnson, who had a step on his man from the other side as the eyes of the young quarterback went left to right. The defender came right to left, and he never saw Quentin Andrews. Nice play by Andrews.
Andrews, redshirt freshman from the state of Florida, now with 4 interceptions on the season. As Steve Slayton, trying to get things going, picks up 7. Jeremy Burnett with a stop. And you see Andrews, actually the only returning starter in that defensive backfield, a guy we talked about a lot today, Eric Wicks, who has the interception and a sack. But Andrews, one of the new starters with a pretty good freshman season for Rich Rodriguez.
Yeah, the words his coach has used, he's coming along. Jeff Castile, the defensive coordinator, said he's really coming along. He's reading things well, and that was a good example.
Second and a long two here for West Virginia. White under pressure, loses the football. South Florida has it and scores the touchdown. George Selvey picks it up, and just like that, we have a tie game.
What happens when you come out flat in a football game? Little things start to give way. The protection's not quite right. This is supposed to be some trickery here. This is a bootleg, a naked boot. So instead of putting the ball away like you normally would, White holds the ball out. Excellent play there by Chris Robinson, who rakes the ball out, picks it up, and runs it in. And if you think Rich Rodriguez is unhappy, if you think that's an expression of anxiety, you're exactly right. It does not feel good.
That is the fifth fumble that Chris Robinson has forced this year. And the extra point added on. And South Florida, which has been dominated offensively in this game, with the giveaway and the touchdown scored by George Selvey, now lead West Virginia 7-6. West Virginia fans can't quite believe this one. They are trailing South Florida now 7-6, about midway through the second quarter. And Pat White cut his hand on that last play. That's the bad news, but the good news is he's a left-handed thrower. But it has been a rough go. George Selvey scoring the touchdown after the fumble forced by Chris Robinson.
Well, Selvey's been the most productive of the defensive linemen, and he's another freshman. This is the youngest. Jim Leavitt says this is the youngest team we've ever had.
So nowhere to go but up for this team in the Big East. Bouncing ball picked up by Raynaud. And Darius is stopped down around the 29-yard line by Sam Miller. That's a 23-yard return. Here's Dave Ryan. Dave.
Pam, I was right next to Pat White there when he was being taped up. That non-throwing hand, his right hand got a little scratch on that play. He's okay. What I did notice, though, is his personality. This is one of the most laid-back players and selfless players, a true team athlete. That's what Rich Rodriguez, the head coach at WVU, told us this week when we spoke to him. Pat White is calm under the most possible duress. So I think if you're a Mountaineer fan, don't panic. You're leading. Looks like he's very relaxed right now.
I remember last week against Pittsburgh, they were struggling a little bit. They had a couple of special team snafus, gave up a punt return for a touchdown, a long kickoff return as well. But then they really turned it on in the second half. And right, Ryan, he's a cool customer. But Steve Slayton, who goes down by Danny Verpale, the free safety, and some of the fans went oof when he went down because that was a pretty big hit.
The hand problems with the backfield here seem to be spreading. Steve Slayton's had trouble with his right hand, so here he is running to his right, but you'll notice the ball's in his left arm, where he carries it all the time now, not unlike Emmitt Smith used to, and the reason is because he has an injured hand.
It's a chronically hurt right wrist that they will perform surgery on once the season is over, so the natural right-hander carries it in his left hand no matter what, and here going left and going down. Jeremy Burnett drops Slayton for a 3-yard loss. Another update now. Here's Linda Cohn.
Pam and Bill, it's the 115th meeting between Missouri and Kansas. It's the border showdown. A little trickeration. Missouri quarterback Chase Daniel takes the snap in the end and get it back. And the throw to Martin Rucker, just perfect. Rucker down to the 10. Tigers ran it in a couple of plays later. They're in control of Kansas, 20-7.
Thank you, Linda. Kansas is one of the teams that has beaten South Florida on the year. They are 7-4 on the season on 3rd and 10. White again. The South Florida defense. These guys are playing great football. It's Josh Jolmes, who has played a heck of a game so far. Wally Burnham, this guy's been around forever in college football, and he's got to be pleased with what he's seen so far.
Yeah, Wally played for Coach Bryant at Alabama. Coached with Mickey Andrews at Florida State. He understands intense defensive play, as does Jim Leavitt. And they are really, you are right, Pam, they are playing outstanding defense, and West Virginia is not helping its cause by being just a little slower than normal.
Look out for Ian Randolph, number 80. He has had 3 punt return touchdowns called back because of penalties, and no surprise, they don't want the ball anywhere near him. As that McAfee punt trickles out at the 34-yard line. Only a 38-yard punt, but at least no return by the talented Randolph. Coming up later today, ESPN and ESPN2 have two big college football games. First, ESPN2 at 4:15 Eastern. It's unbeaten Boise State against Nevada. Then at 7:45 Eastern, Wake Forest or Maryland. Whoever wins that game plays in the ACC title game against Georgia Tech. Rivalry Week presented by Remington on ESPN and ESPN2 later today. College football lives here. And Pat White already has had his hand scratched and taped up, and they're looking at him again. He's getting hit a lot today. And now the fans starting to rev up their team. First and 10 for the Bulls from the 34. Empty backfield, Matt Grothy, the redshirt freshman, little pump fake, and all alone on the sidelines. That was a blown coverage as Marcus Edwards gathers it in, 12 yards in the first down.
You see everybody up at the line of scrimmage in this 3-5-3 defense, but they dropped eight. And there should be a man in the flat. And, Pam, you got it exactly right. That was a blown coverage. It's hard to tell who was supposed to be out there. But clearly, one of the corners was not where he was supposed to be. That's too easy a throw when you're dropping eight.
First and ten from the 46. Grothy, the leading rusher on this team, hangs onto it and picks up 4 yards. Boo McClee coming in to get his first tackle of the game. West Virginia, the overwhelming favorite to beat South Florida today, but they are losing. And you see that South Florida fast gaining in total yardage.
They're also fast gaining in confidence. When you let a team hang around like this, they start to believe they can win.
Now second and six from midfield. With time, finds his man again. It is Marcus Edwards who got a big-time hit, but still was able to hang on to the ball. 13 yards and another first down.
This is one of those sophisticated blitz packages that you get from teams like this, where they're running all over the lot, and a wonderful job up front. You can see the linebackers crossing, and you see the two offensive linemen switching off here, picking up both of them. Plenty of time for Grothy to get this ball thrown. What a great job of protection by the big guys up front.
Remember, he was sacked 6 times in the loss last week to Louisville. He's gone down a couple of times today, but Grothy can make things happen with his feet. He's going to hang on to it and picks up a couple of yards. Jay Henry, the senior, making the stop. Henry, a great academic success story, has never had a B, not only at West Virginia, but in his whole life.
Well, I never made no B's myself.
But from the other end, This kid has only had A's.
Oh.
And he's already received a degree in finance. He's going for a second degree.
In accounting.
How about that? He's a Draddy finalist?
Yep. He's a National Football Foundation scholar athlete this year. What a great honor. And also a heck of a football player.
He's the smart guy. Second and eight for the Bulls. 5 receivers in for Grothy. Finds one of them, but that is knocked down by Eric Wicks. The heart and soul of that defensive backfield as he was looking for Taurus Johnson.
When somebody makes big plays all the time, it's usually because they understand leverage. Look at Wicks's angle. He's just underneath the receiver. And Grothy thought he could sort of aim that ball and get it in there. Wicks, too good an angle, too good athlete. He got up in the air and got a piece of it. Third big play of the day by Wicks.
Yep, he has an interception, a sack, and now that big breakup. South Florida 3-for-5 on third down so far today. This is a 3rd and 8. Grothy retreats. And then he lets it go and finds his receiver for the first down. The flag is down. The question is, as Taurus Johnson, he was very close to the line of scrimmage when he let go of the ball. I thought he was just going to take off and run for the first down.
This guy is a creator. Looks like he's coming back. Okay, lineman downfield. And that's just inexcusable. Your quarterback bails you out. He makes a great, great play. You got to watch it. You got to see this to believe it. This time the protection is very poor. Look, I mean, the house is broken in. The roof is caved in. And here goes Grothy, who improvises, makes a great play for you, and some lineman is downfield. Just no excuse for it. It looked like to us that it was number 75, Walter Walker, who's a great talent but does not always think as well as he should. His coaches are proud of the progress he's made this year, but they said we really need him to play well. So instead of having the ball inside the five, here's South Florida back out at the 40-yard line.
That erased a 29-yard gain and a first down. Now it's third and 13. Murphy actually let go of that ball a couple of yards away from the line of scrimmage. So he made a good play, but the lineman didn't help him out. That pass is complete. Depends on the mark as Edwards has become the go-to guy on this drive. Picks up 12 yards, and from here appears to be a half yard shorter of the first down.
One of the examples of a polished passing game is the capacity to throw the slant in virtually any situation. It goes right by Wicks. I'm telling you, Grothy has no intimidation factor. This kid believes in himself, he believes in his receivers, and he just keeps his team in the game. To quote one of his coaches, Rod Smith, the offensive coordinator, this guy has carried this team, and I can see how.
And now on fourth and one, the play clock winding down. We anticipate a timeout. Grothy is right there to call it. Does so with 1 second left on the play clock and 1:06 to go in the first half. So Matt Grothy, wise beyond his years, will face a big fourth and one when we return. Fourth and one for South Florida. What do you think they should do?
I think it's time to put it up. Well, obviously, they're lining up, and I thought they'd get all bunched up. You put it up and try to score here.
After the timeout, redshirt freshman quarterback Matt Grothy, looks like he's changing it up already.
Can't go play action with an empty backfield. I was thinking play action.
Grothy can always run it, but instead he completes it to Ian Randolph, and Randolph gets the first down. He was by himself out there, caught it for a 6-yard gain and the first down for the Bulls.
It is a whole new ball game, and I do not mean that in a cliche way. Things are so different. Fourth and one, to see somebody in empty backfield, and Rich Rodriguez only has himself to blame. Everybody is using his offense. In fact, Rod Smith, the offensive coordinator for South Florida, played quarterback under Rodriguez.
At Glenville State, where he was an All-American quarterback, Grothy crawling his way to the 17-yard line. South Florida has two timeouts remaining. And there is Smith. We asked him on the phone how much stuff he had borrowed from Coach Rodriguez. He said quite a bit.
All of it.
Yeah, all of it. Quite a bit would be all of it.
Are you kidding me? Of course. Rich Rodriguez stuff.
They take a timeout. Only one remaining. So it's second and five from the 17. More great college football coming your way tonight. 8 Eastern time, 5 Pacific on ABC. Notre Dame takes on USC. Pete Carroll, of course, looking for another BCS championship game bid. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines, part of Rivalry Week, presented by Remington on ABC.
Two things the BCS has done for all of us. Number one, it gives us something to talk about for months and months, and we love arguing about it. And number two, it's given us the most interesting regular season of any of the big sports. You cannot give me another sport that has this kind of interest, in which every game all year draws as much attention, and especially as we get toward the end. It's just great fun to watch all these big games and have your opinions and argue about it.
People in the Southeast Conference can argue about the winner of that coming out and maybe getting a snub. Here is your All-State standings review. Ohio State, the big dog, and a lot of people are talking about Michigan getting another shot at Ohio State, but look at West Virginia. They are hoping for a BCS bid as the Big East champion. They certainly have a shot at that, but first they got to beat South Florida today. They don't beat South Florida today, they won't do it. That pass is completed. Does he get out of bounds? Yes, he does. First down at the 10-yard line by Taurus Johnson.
Well, I need not tell any reasonably sophisticated football person that West Virginia got their hands full today. These guys came here to have some fun and play some tackle football, and that's what they're doing. And West Virginia is not getting the message. They're being handled here. This is really surprising.
And they're playing in sort of Florida weather. It's gorgeous today. Temperatures up around 60 degrees right now. And then carrying it all the way into the end zone for the touchdown, Matt Grothy. Grothy behind the block of Matt Huners and company extends the lead for the Bulls.
Matt Grothy, we showed him with the quarterback sneak a while ago. He got his pads down. He moved his feet. Here is just a simple off-tackle play. There's no subterfuge here. It's just man-on-man blocking. Jake Griffin, number 77, did a great job. Just manhandled his guy for the touch.
Ninth touchdown on the ground this year for Grothy as that extra point barely sneaks through the uprights, but barely is good enough. It's 14-6 South Florida.
I said that was Jake Griffith. Instead, it was 71, Matt Huners, that did a nice job. Actually, he couldn't find anybody to block because there was nobody there. So I gave him too much credit. He just kind of went out there. And fortunately, he did get himself out of the way in time for the fleet little quarterback to run it in there.
Our sonic scoring drive. It took him 4 minutes and 13 seconds to go 66 yards, capped off by Grothy's 10-yard touchdown run. He is first in the nation among freshman quarterback in total offense, rushing yards by quarterback, and now has 9 touchdown runs, leading rusher on this team. And Coach Leavitt's team is up 14-6 over mighty West Virginia.
And this is with Grothy making the mistake and throwing the interception. This is with him taking some big sacks and still coming back and recovering and making first downs in spite of those mistakes.
Grothy 11 for 15 through the air, but has thrown 2 picks. He's been sacked a couple of times, as Bill said. But lo and behold, they're up 14-6. Renaud can't handle the kick cleanly. And he is stopped down around the 32-yard line with 22 seconds left. West Virginia has all 3 of its timeouts remaining. Last year, these two teams played in Raymond James Stadium. Pat White was remarkable, 177 yards on the ground, including rushing touchdowns of 65 and 76 yards. Steve Slayton held only 86 yards on 28 carries. Pat White, the first West Virginia quarterback to run for 100 yards in 3 straight games. He has made a habit of that. It is quite a different story today. As West Virginia is down 14-6, Slayton only 3.1 yards per carry, which is a career low for him. The other quarterback, Pat Jolmes, now the backup quarterback, was the starter. As West Virginia won at 28-13, and Pat White only 21 yards on 9 carries. He has been sacked. But what about Steve Slayton? 10 carries for 26 yards. That's 2.6 yards per carry, which would be a new career low for him if that holds up.
But we've raved about Grothy and the offensive excellence of University of South Florida, especially on the last drive. But the real story of this game is the South Florida defense and those swarming linebackers making play after play. Strong safety Jeremy Burnett, big loss. Josh Jewell-Miss coming alive and doing the things that he's capable of doing. George Selvey raking the ball out, picking it up, running for a touchdown. Those are the things you have to do to win a game when you're an underdog.
After the West Virginia timeout, now they have 2 remaining. First and 10 from the 33. And Pat White has nowhere to go, and it's Jolmes again.
There's just not a lot of zip in the step of the Mountaineers, even now that they're down. You don't see people running crisp routes. Everybody's covered. Protection finally breaks down. Not what we expected to see today.
Another timeout is taken by the Mountaineers. They are down to 1 as you take a look at Jim Leavitt, the architect of this program, literally starting from scratch. Their offices used to be in trailers on the campus, which is in Tampa. He's from St. Petersburg, calls it a dream job. He's from there, his folks, his family all around there, and he gets to coach there.
He is really, and he's so proud of this team, Pam. He said this bunch has just fought and fought, and they're so young. A lot of them have no idea what's going on yet, but they are figuring it out. And then he started to talk about his program. He said, now think, we were nothing in 1997. We just started, I mean, with the trailers and no real scholarship football players. We're 2-2 versus Louisville. We're 2-2 versus Pitt. We're 2-2 versus Cincinnati. We are a competitive Big East team. And he's really proud of all that they've accomplished. And he says it's only a matter of time until we're among the big players in college football, and I'm tending to believe him.
There's a lot of great high school talent in the state of Florida. It kind of slips through the cracks, and now that they are in the Big East, even more recruiting doors have been open. White just sits back and chucks it downfield. He had a receiver wide open, but it will be intercepted. Jeremy Burnett with the pickoff as White's pass was underthrown, and that is the final play of the first half. So Jeremy Burnett with his second pick of the season ends the first half, and West Virginia is serenaded by a chorus of boos from many of these fans. Jim Leavitt standing by with Dave Ryan.
Coach Matt Grothy just had that 10-yard touchdown run. How would you describe his first half?
Well, you know, he made some, you know, the early throws of interception, you know, that was a bad play. And also, he's just got to not take a sack, you know, get the ball out of bounds. You know, we lost some field position on our punt game, you know, a couple times. But, you know, overall, doing a pretty good job.
10 days ago, WVU against Pittsburgh's Keith Slate and Pat White, each run for 200 yards. You shut them down pretty well in the first half. Why, Coach?
Well, first half. It's just, it's a 60-minute ball game. We got to, you know, we got a long way to go.
All right, Rhino, those two guys, White and Slayton, have combined for only 33 yards on the ground. The fans can't believe what they're seeing. South Florida up 14-6 as we head to Linda Cohn with the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report. Second half about to get underway. We have an upset brewing in Morgantown. South Florida leading West Virginia by the score of 14-6. At the half, here are our first half stats presented by Remington. And you see the rush yards, not much going there for South Florida, but West Virginia's had a couple of crucial miscues and have not taken a really great advantage of great field position. They tried a fake field goal where they were down inside the 10. That didn't work. And they only have a couple of field goals to show for their effort in the first half. Matt Grothy running the show, the redshirt freshman quarterback for South Florida. He has run for a touchdown today, and has, as we look at our game track, this turnover. Robinson with the strip, George Selby with the score. The first touchdown for South Florida, and then Matt Grothy, the leading rusher on this team, doing it by himself to make it 14-6 in favor of South Florida. Pam Ward along with Bill Curry, who is in for Mike Godfrey today. And it's been a rather surprising first half, but you have to give a lot of credit to the South Florida defense.
South Florida defense has been outstanding. Now, I imagine, had we been in the West Virginia locker room, we might have witnessed a Rich Rodriguez revival program. I imagine he got after his guys big time. I certainly think they need it, and they're going to need to play hard to win this football game. They're going to have to cut out the mistakes and start blocking somebody and play really well in the second half, because South Florida is serious about this business, and Grothy is the real deal, even with his two interceptions.
He's also been sacked a couple of times. Jim Leavitt in charge of this South Florida program. Now in its 10th season of existence, they are bowl eligible for the second time. Last year they went to a bowl where they lost to NC State. West Virginia, let's see what that little pep talk, shall we say, from Rich Rodriguez did to this team as West Virginia gets the ball first. Darius Raynaud, dangerous whenever he touches the ball. And that's a nice way to start the second half, a 31-yard return for him. Houston Hess with the stop. Let's take a look at just how good that defense was in the first half. Steve Slayton, 10 carries for 26 yards. Pat White going down a couple of times. Josh Jolmes played a heck of a first half.
Josh Jolmes is supposed to be growing up. Well, the young man decided to do it today. He has certainly acquitted himself well.
So, last time they did not have a first half touchdown a year ago, plus against Louisville. They came back to win that exciting game in triple overtime. Steve Slayton was fabulous in that game. Not so fabulous so far in this one. And they give it to Slayton to start off the half, and he picks up three on first down. Let's go down to the field now, Dave Ryan.
All right, Pam, I did speak with WVU head coach Rich Rodriguez, and you guys talking in the booth about the emotion of his halftime speech. He said, I didn't get too hot under the collar, didn't yell too much. He said, it was not a lack of effort, it was a lack of execution. Guys, keep in mind, WVU this year at home is 5-0. They average 44.4 points a game on their home field. They scored 222 points here at home. What's going on here, guys?
Only six so far. They've been facing the stout defense, and White completes it to Brandon Miles. They're going to be about 3 yards short of the first down. Trey Williams makes the stop.
Well, Rich is certainly right that it's a lack of execution. He'll have to judge the effort level on for himself. But when your heart and mind and soul are not into this game completely, then you look sluggish, and that's the way West Virginia has looked.
10 days ago, they beat Pittsburgh in the backyard brawl. They have Rutgers next week, and Pat White picks up the first down. That's the Pat White we're used to seeing. He gets 9, and they move the chains. Remember last week against Pittsburgh, both White and Slayton ran for over 200 yards apiece.
And this is the West Virginia answer for power football. This is nothing but the old power eye. They got two blockers lined up to the left of the ball carrier, and they're already back at the line of scrimmage. Can't show it to you, but that was just power football, like single wing almost.
They averaged 330 yards a game on the ground. That's second in the nation. Slayton, that's another good tackle as he is dragged down by Stephen Nicholas. He loses about a half a yard. And this South Florida team has really got it out for Slayton.
Well, they're just not going to let him win the game the way he has so many, many times. And here's the play before you. See the two lead blockers. They got big guys in the backfield. Got linemen in the backfield, and I couldn't even see who they were. It all happened so fast, and it worked. South Florida was surprised as well.
Jeremy Burnett doing a good job on the play we just showed you, stringing it out. Second and 11 now for the Mountaineers. A little reverse. Second time that they have reversed it to Reynaud, and he steps out. They mark him just short of the first down as he picks up 10. That is his specialty, the 12th time that he has carried the ball this season.
And the key block there by Steve Slayton. So if you're not having a good day running the football, what do? Hang your head and mope around? No, you block for your buddy. Great job by Slayton there, who is the strongest of the Mountaineer players in the weight room, and he sure showed it with a key block on a lineman to spring Reynaud just there.
Now 101 total yards, 67 on the ground, 34 through the air. Hit a 57-yard run earlier today. Owen Schmidt, the big fullback, gets the first down on 3rd and 1. First time he's carried the ball today. He was nicked up a couple of weeks ago. We were here for the Cincinnati game. That's when they had a big lead. Rodriguez pulled his starters and then put them back in, and Schmidt was hurt when the starters were put back in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, it's tough getting cooled down and then having to go back out there. But Schmidt's a crowd favorite. You can tell when he runs on the field.
6'3", 250, huge blocker. First and 10, Smith a little bit too much on that pass as he was looking for Brandon Miles out in the flat. Now 2nd and 10.
Just little things, just little mistakes. The ball drops out of your hand. You don't quite finish your job. You don't quite finish your block. The West Virginia offensive line has been stupendous all year. Not so today. They've been outplayed by this undersized, young, aggressive South Florida defense.
White, 6 for 9 through the air, 50 yards and a pick. And now facing a 2nd and 10. To his left, and that's well covered. Hit as soon as he got the ball was Brandon Miles. He's about 5 yards short of the first down.
Another sign of intensity. A nice catch on a hitch here. Miles looks the ball in, catches it in his hands, and all of a sudden he's swarmed under, not by not one, but 2, 3. Mike Jenkins first, Stephen Nicholas, the leading tackler on this defensive unit, and the leading, how should we say, the spirit guy, the esprit de corps guy, is Nicholas.
Some NFL potential as well for Nicholas. Here's a 3rd and 5. West Virginia's first possession of the second half. White, with time, has a guy in the post pattern, and he completes it. Inside the 5, it's Brandon Miles. Miles got a step on Mike Jenkins, and the Mountaineers have a 1st and goal from the 2.
I really like Miles. He's a big 6'3 guy with a nice stride. He's a lot faster than he looks. He gets an inside position here, and the corner's playing it as if he expects help from the inside, and it's not there. A nice throw on the skinny post. beautiful accuracy by Pat White.
So for the fourth time today, they are in the red zone. And White hands it off to Slayton, and right before he gets to the goal line, he fumbles the football. South Florida has it. The question is, will he be marked down?
And what a shot he took. These linebackers have done a great job today.
South Florida football.
Denny Verpale is the guy that laid the lick. So it wasn't the linebacker this time. It was the free safety, Danny Verpale. He came up and just drilled the powerful back. I mean, and Slayton is a strong man. He just knocked that football loose. That was great goal line tackling work. Poor ball security. You put that ball away and you rivet it to your rib cage. You don't ever let that happen.
Ben Moffitt.
Verpale just knocked it out with his headgear. Ben Moffitt comes up with it.
I tell you, we're going to take a look at the play upstairs. Just remember, Steve Slayton lost a couple of big fumbles in that loss to Louisville when he already has a bad right wrist. In that game against Louisville, he hurt his left wrist and also got a hit on his funny bone, so his entire left arm went numb, so he was playing with two bad arms. And he's not a fumbler.
Yeah, that's a terrible feeling with your when your whole hand and arm goes numb. You really can't do anything. For instance, if you're an offensive center and you get your right elbow hit and your whole right arm goes numb, you can't play. You can't hike the ball. You can't hold on to it. Another good look here. Nice penetration by the defensive line, which allows Verpale to actually make the hit before the ball crosses the goal line. Had he done this 6 inches farther, it would have been a touchdown. I'm not sure why they're replaying it. That's a fumble.
South Florida.
And it didn't take them long to get it reviewed. Buddy Ward, the replay official today. And the ball does go over to South Florida. That is the third turnover for West Virginia this afternoon.
Now, the last time West Virginia's defense had a chance to bottle these guys up deep in their territory, they couldn't do it. South Florida came off the goal line. Let's see what happens here.
First and 10, and Grothy hangs on to it, trying to get him a little bit of breathing room, gets him a yard. We get you Dave Ryan. Rhino.
Well, Pam, what did Rich Rodriguez tell us this week? It's been a Jekyll and Hyde thing for his team this season. First half and the second half, they were down, guys, to Pittsburgh 10 days ago, 27-24 at the half. They won that game to the Mountaineers in the backyard brawl, 45-27. He said, hey, same calls, but more passion needed, more energy. We need more bounce on step for four quarters, not just two. Maybe it happens here in the second half. We'll see.
They are waiting for that passion to kick in. Second and 8 for the Bulls. Play clock winding down. Grothy just gets it off. Hands it off to Ponton, and he goes down. After picking up a half yard or so, Boo McClee making the stop. His birthday was yesterday. It was Boo. And here's your 3rd and 8. Here's a chance for this West Virginia defense. Get a stop and get some good field position on the other end.
Yeah, what you do in these situations is you bottle them up. You make them kick out of the back of their end zone. You get the ball on your 40-yard line. You knock it in for a touchdown and overcome your mistakes.
And Grothy rolling to his right. And throws it out of bounds as his two receivers, including Ian Randolph, were well covered. And Rich Rodriguez's team does come up with a stop when they needed it. And now they'll get an opportunity to get the ball in South Florida territory.
Calculated risk down there by Jeff Castile, the defensive coordinator for West Virginia, in man coverage. But the coverage was superb and forced the throwaway. And now the punter has to punt the ball without having his normal depth. He's at the back of the end zone. He only has 12 yards. That's a risky proposition.
Justin Tichy, the walk-on punter. Low-line drive should be returnable, taken at the 40. And West Virginia going to start from around the 28. Antonio Lewis, who was all Big East first team at kick returns and punt returns last year, gets an 11-yard return. Here comes Pat White and Steve Slayton in good field position. This telecast is available on ESPN2 HD, presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. And West Virginia in good shape, starting at the 28-yard line, but trailing 14-6 to South Florida. We're still waiting for Steve Slayton to break out. Gets that carry. There's a nice run. Slayton for the first down inside the 15. The last time he carried the ball, he fumbled it. Let's head over now with an update and Linda Cohn.
Okay, Pam. Florida leads Florida State 14-0 at the half. But in the second quarter, Percy Harvin, who had scored a touchdown earlier, will catch this pass. He's hit, and he falls awkwardly. Harvin had to be carted off on a stretcher. No word on his injury yet, but Harvin did give a thumbs up as he was being wheeled off. We will keep you posted on Percy Harvin's injury, Pam.
All right, thank you, Linda. Always scary when you see those potential head or neck injuries, so be careful with him. And there's the thumb up. Florida leading Florida State 14-0. Here's Steve Slayton's 13-yard run, the longest of the day, and then he backs it up by going backwards. George Selvey, who scored a touchdown on a recovered fumble, with the stop. That's the sixth time today that Slayton has been stopped at or behind the line of scrimmage.
And Selvey's been a dominant player, 95. Lined up there on Ryan Sanchek, is just overpowering up the field. And that really, that was a virtually impossible block for Sanchek anyhow, but he got manhandled. And that's not the first time today that's happened. Excellent defensive work by the Bulls.
And half a dozen times he's been dropped for a loss. Slayton this time catching the ball. And that's a good ankle tackle. He only picked up 7 yards. Chris Robinson able to get him low, or else Slayton might have been heading towards the end zone.
Yeah, I think he was gone. I mean, it was just the barest loss of balance that got him on the ground. He focused on the football. He made sure of the catch. There have been so many mistakes today. Conscientious players begin to do things at times like this.
This will not do. West Virginia usually so good in the red zone. 4 trips, only 6 points. Last time they were down there, Slayton fumbled right at the goal line. 3rd and 10, high snap. White controls it. Going into the corner of the end zone, and the ball is caught by Brandon Miles. A terrific leaping catch for the West Virginia touchdown.
When your team is in trouble, great players make great plays. And you can start this from catching a poor snap by Dan Moses, the center, who's thinking about pulling. And this is just a wonderful throw and catch. This is execution. This doesn't just happen. Brandon Miles, number 7, and Pat White have done that thousands and thousands of times.
White throws a lot more in practice usually than he does in a game. And now they're going for 2 to try to tie this game up. White forcing it in, and it is incomplete as it one hops towards the intended receiver. He was going for Darius Raynaud.
Not a good idea to go for 2 here. You got a better chance of scoring 2 by kicking it twice than by going for 2 twice.
Yeah, I agree. I always say take the point when you can get it. Well, that's a great leaping catch by Miles, but South Florida's still winning this ball game.
ESPN2's College Football, brought to you by Mercedes-Benz, located on the web at mbusa.com. And T. Rowe Price, mutual funds, IRAs, college savings from T. Rowe Price. Invest with confidence.
Look at the Mon River Trail, the old railroad tracks. It heads all the way out towards Washington, D.C. On a gorgeous day here in Morgantown, West Virginia just throwing a touchdown pass on 3rd and 10, a 15-yard strike. Pat White and Brandon Miles, not so much as a strike. It was more like high and outside, but Miles was able to bring it in.
It was a strike to Miles.
Yep.
He went up and got it.
Oh, boy, Slayton getting his left elbow looked at down on the sidelines. They only had do, a 28-yard drive on that play. Erskine gets it, gets the kickoff, and is stopped down around the 35-yard line, or 30-yard line. Here's Linda Cohen. Linda.
Pam, your game is tight. How about this one? Kentucky at number 19, Tennessee. Andre Woodson with a 5-yard touchdown pass to Raphael Little. Tennessee looking to beat Kentucky for the 22nd straight time, but Kentucky is beating Tennessee right now by the score of 12-10. Also, game on ESPN, Clemson taking out South Carolina so far. C.J. Spiller, 2 touchdowns, 118 yards on just 5 carries.
Well, Linda, that's the kind of stuff we're used to getting from Steve Slayton, but Slayton has been struggling in our game. 15 carries, only 35 yards. South Florida with a 2-point lead in the football. Grothy, their quarterback, breaking free for the first down as he gets it all the way up to the 44. That's 14 more yards for Matt.
Good quarterbacks and good quarterback coaches work on this every day. What this ball does is it disappears from the linebackers. They still don't know where it is. The ball handling happened here. The linebackers are still headed the wrong way because the quarterback did a nice job of faking. It's an ancient art and much lost in many systems today.
Grothy has been their leading rusher in 6 of their 11 games, despite being sacked quite often. He's been sacked twice today. That's a completion to Devin Gordon, the tight end, for another Bulls first down.
Now, I could draw up exactly the same picture I did on the last one and show that the linebackers went the wrong way on that nice fake by Grothy.
This is his work so far today. Run, the second touchdown. Been sacked a couple of times, which skews the rushing yards. But he is still their leading ball carrier this afternoon. Cotton gets the ball this time and picks up about 3. Let's go down the sidelines now, and Dave Ryan.
How does South Florida look right now, Pam? Bill, relaxed and confident. Remember, guys, this program is only in its 10th season, 8 of 10 regular winning seasons so far. Jim Leavitt told us this week that his team wouldn't be bothered by playing this game at Mountaineer Field today. Think about some of the games they took earlier to get the program established. Oklahoma, Alabama, South Carolina, Arkansas, Penn State. Players and coaches in their second year, the Big East, first ever road game here in the Big East for them. Feel they're ready. They look good so far, Pam.
They sure do. They look like they were more ready to play today than West Virginia as Grothy sneaks inside and gets it down to the 35, picks up a couple of yards. Mark Magro making the stop.
West Virginia has an unusual defense in that they line up in a 3-5-3 alignment, and they can give you all kinds of stunts and fronts that you're not accustomed to seeing. But a nice job of zone blocking there, just picking up whoever comes in your zone by the offensive line of South Florida.
Bulls now with a 3rd and 4 from the 35. Grothy throwing it underneath and a slipped tackle. Torrance Johnson broke a tackle to get the first down. Johnson all the way down to the 19. There was a flag down around the 28. Actually, a couple of them in the same spot. Around the 22-yard line.
Dead ball. Personal foul. Number 65 on the offense. Unnecessary roughness. 15 yards from the spot of the foul. We play the down.
Oh, that's a big one because that was a first down, Bill. That's Ryan Schmidt, yeah, the right guard, a transfer from Kansas State.
Wicks, who's had such a good day, is in man coverage here. A little turn back to the outside and a missed tackle this time. That's Torrance Johnson, the fastest man on the South Florida team, number 89, to go down that sideline for the first down. And then a foolish penalty by Ryan Schmidt, number 65, who takes a cheap shot late in the play. Had nothing to do with the football game or the play, and I guarantee you he will pay with Coach Leavitt.
Schmidt, the sophomore from Boca Raton, and still a first down. But they mark the ball 15 yards back at the 30.
Yeah, I played for Coach Bobby Dodd at Georgia Tech, and the only time he ever jumped me and chewed me out in front of a full house crowd is when I did something like that. And you, every now and then you just do something stupid, and then you're sorry for it immediately, and you're more sorry later.
They Got 19 yards on a third and four. You take away the 15 yards, still a first down. And it is first and 10 from the 30. Grothy with the pitch to Ponton. Good blocking on the outside. Ponton steps out of bounds. And it was S.J. Green, number 81, the wide receiver, gave him a good block out there, and he picks up 8 yards.
Now, what you would hope, you go in at the half, and you sort of get in your kid's face, and you got them jacked up, and they're going to come out and play well. You go out, and you get the first touchdown. Even though you fumble the ball, you come back down, score the touchdown. But now you're missing tackles. Eric Wicks misses a big tackle. Quentin Andrews missed that tackle. That's just not paying attention to your business.
Now they face a second and 3 from the 23. South Florida up 14-12 on number 7, West Virginia. Grothy keeps it. Grothy appears to have another first down. Wicks in on the stop. But South Florida keeps this drive going.
Matt Hooners is doing a nice job of pulling and kicking out. They've had several plays that are not unlike a power play, except that he blocks the outside guy. The left guard will pull here and kick out, and it's just extremely well executed. Good job. Moves his feet. The big man, athletic ability.
And again, this offensive line has a lot of guys playing at their non-customary positions because of suspensions and injuries. Benjamin Williams in the backfield. That's Ponton who gets the ball as a flag comes in from behind. Ponton was dropped for a 2-yard loss.
Now, your guys have played well all day long. They fought and scratched, and they're ahead in the game. And now things start to come unglued as fatigue sets in. Maybe that's what's going
on
in South Florida.
Number 69 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. We play first down.
Nick Capone, the center, and I might add a good center. Right here in the lower left, you got a perfect shot by our cameraman. You can see him. He's got a death lock on Pat Liebig's jersey. You just can't get away with that, nor should you.
Capone is a converted tight end, now playing center, a good athlete, but that time he had a lot of Liebig's jersey. So they've had a personal foul on this drive, and now the hold, first and 20 from the 30. First and 20 instead of what would have been a second and 12 with Ponton getting dropped in the backfield. Now Grothy hangs on to it again. Grothy stretching but falling down about a yard short of the first down. Johnny Dingle coming in to make the stop.
What we got is a 2-deep with 5 underneath man coverage. So you got people all across here are manned up. They're not looking at the quarterback. There is nobody. If he breaks the line of scrimmage, he's got a long way to run, which he did. A perfect call for that coverage.
And it's about a yard short of the original line of scrimmage, not the first down marker, my mistake. So it's second and 11.
But they got half of what they needed, and that's what you want to do on first down.
Throws, completes it to Randolph, and Ian Randolph, so dangerous in space, shows us all why, as Randolph steps out at the 1-yard line. Ian Randolph, the leading receiver on this team, just gets the ball and takes off.
Great job of blocking here by S.J. Green, number 81. He's out in front of Randolph, who looks the ball in. Look at Green stay on his feet, get his man on the ground. What a great job. Randolph would love to have his play back. He made several nice moves. One that wasn't so nice is stepping out on the 2.
Boy, how does he not score on that? And they are going to look at it upstairs.
Okay, this is one of the things. Anything that involves a line or possession of the ball can be reviewed. So whether he stepped out or crossed the line, we'll see what we have here. Wow.
I think that's a touchdown.
It's 6 points.
Yep. From up here, it looked like he didn't step out. That's a great angle again.
But, Pam, there's no way you would have missed the call.
Oh, wow.
That's for sure.
From up here.
I mean, you can see it.
Wow.
That's gift. Play-by-play people just have that gift.
Some of them do. So this play under official review. Here's another angle.
This won't be as good. We won't be able to tell here, but we could tell from that previous angle he really kept his feet in and scored the touchdown. Here we go. In.
Yep, there's a lot of green.
Well, yeah.
There's at least an inch of green.
With an inch of green there.
That's a touchdown. So Ian Randolph, as they take a look at it upstairs.
And this is the good news about the system. Every single play is reviewed. The coach does not have to throw a little flag out on the field to get the officials to observe it. The folks upstairs will call down and say, we need to take a look at that because it looks like he might have scored.
Based on indisputable video evidence, the result of the play is a touchdown.
Absolutely. Good job, and the video replay works again. So Ian Randolph with a 21-yard touchdown catch. And look at this. It's 20-12 South Florida.
And who would have thunk it?
West Virginia, about a 3-touchdown favorite coming into this game. Delbert Alvarado, true freshman kicker, makes it 21-12. 69-yard drive, took 9 plays. Ian Randolph catches it, and then his speed does the rest. 21-yard touchdown. Pat White, the quarterback, number 7, West Virginia, on the sidelines, getting his guys ready to go. And he's the kind of guy, we talk about growthy a lot, a redshirt freshman. Pat is only a sophomore, and he's a good leader as well.
He's a marvelous leader. He takes responsibility. I've seen him do this time after time. That's what the great ones do. They get on the bench, and they take responsibility for their mistakes, and then they get everybody to think that way.
Growthy has been fabulous. He is now over 3,000 yards of total offense this season. Rushing and passing. West Virginia got to get it going. Renaud feels it at his goal line. And he takes it out close to the 28-yard line. But a flag is down back at the 37-yard line on the other side of the field.
This is a penalty that could be called a lot against a lot of teams. Offside, you'll see people a step ahead of the kicker, and they'll
offside.
Usually give you a little grace.
Penalty will assessed from the 35-yard line. Re-kick.
That's why Jim Leavitt's on the field saying, come on, guys, come on, give us a break here. If the officials don't call this on a regular basis, then guys get a little careless and they get anxious to get out there and get ahead and go down and make a tackle. And again, it could be called a lot of times and usually is not. So somebody may have been really flagrantly offsides there. So now Jim's going to get on his guys. It's one of those little tricky areas that is not called consistently in college or NFL football.
Jim Leavitt went out onto the field to talk to his players, and the fans got on him a little bit. Justin Tichy is the kickoff specialist.
It's a little bit like the turning double plays. And did the shortstop really have his foot on the bag?
Mm-hmm.
First baseman, did he really catch that before he stepped off the bag to get out of the way of the runner? It's something that's sort of a grace thing that develops over the years with the umpires and the officials.
You very rarely see it called. You're right, they did call it here. Second kickoff this time. From the 30, it is fielded by Vaughn Rivers, and Rivers breaking away, but is finally stopped around the 36-yard line after a 24-yard return. Let's head back to Linda Cohen.
West Virginia looking to get it going. How about Rutgers? They already had last home game of the year, just crushing Syracuse. Fifth-year senior Brian Leonard, the inspiration of this team, breaking a few tackles on third down, and then he finished the deal. His 43rd touchdown of the year for Leonard, second among active players. Rutgers firing off the cannons to celebrate. West Virginia wishes they were firing off their cannon a bit more.
I tell you, Linda, they fire the musket here that always that makes people jump, and they haven't had any reason, not many reasons to be happy at all. Now they're down 21-12, and that's just not going to do it. as White goes down immediately. George Selvey, that's a five-yard loss.
Yeah, this is just a well-orchestrated defensive call. Wally Burnham, the fine defensive coordinator for South Florida, it's a stunt coming inside. He steps up the field. George Selvey drives down inside, no blocker for him because it was not expected, and a hit in the backfield, five-yard loss.
So now second and 15 for the Mountaineers, closing in on 2 minutes left to go in the third quarter. Slate running well up to around the 42-yard line, picks up 11. Jeremy Burnett coming up with the stop. Molly Burnham, the defensive coordinator, seventh year at South Florida, sixth as the coordinator. We asked him during the week, how do you stop Slayton and White? He said, well, we could play 14 guys. That'll do it. Of course, you can only play 11, but it looks like they've had 14 out there at times on the field today.
Yeah, that's what you want it to look like. They got too many guys, and that's the way they've played today.
And now they have a third and four to try to stop. West Virginia 7 for 11 on third downs today, but they're down. White with time finds his man over the middle right at midfield, but the pass is dropped as he was looking for Brandon Tate, the tight end, the first time we've seen him today, and he was hit hard by Steve Nicholas.
Now here's where I have to question the coaches a little bit. You're playing and you're fighting for your life here, so you got a critical situation where you really desperately need a first down, and you put a guy in that hasn't been playing. You throw the ball over the middle. He tries to make the catch. He gets drilled by the ever-present Steven Nicholas, and the ball goes on the ground. Why not somebody that's been playing that's more likely to bring the ball in the heat of the battle?
Tate has zero catches this year. Fourth and four, so they punt. Ian Randolph, so dangerous. Fair catches it, though, at his 22. 36-yard punt, no return. Coming up on ABC tonight, oh, what a game we got for you. Pete Carroll has the USC Trojans thinking another BCS championship game spot. They face Charlie Weiss and the Fighting Irish at the Coliseum. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines, part of Rivalry Week, presented by Remington on ABC. Brady Quinn, over 3,000 passing yards, 32 touchdowns. A lot of people have him on their Heisman list. That's a big one tonight on ABC.
Got him second on the Heisman list.
On yours.
On everybody's.
Mm-hmm. Troy Smith, the overwhelming favorite. Inside a minute in the third quarter. Grothy fires it out to Randolph. And Ian steps out of bounds after about a six-yard gain. Let's head down to Dave Ryan for more on Grothy.
Yeah, Pam and Bill, just hanging out on the bench here for South Florida, right behind Matt Grothy while the defense was holding West Virginia again. You just get the feeling from watching this young redshirt freshman, who should, by the way, be the Big East Rookie of the Year, no question about it. He is so calm, cool, and collected. He's expecting to be in this game, to be leading this game, and to put his Bulls in a great position to be in a top-10 team. He's expecting this, guys, no doubt about it.
It's the way he played in high school. It's the way he's played this entire year.
And now on a second and four, Grothy, who's from Lakeland, Florida, retreating, and this could be a significant loss, but Grothy makes something out of nothing. Bobby Hathaway, the linebacker, pursued him. He only lost 2 yards on that. It could have been a whole lot worse. A couple of good young quarterbacks. And Matt Grothy, who would have thought that he would be, especially in rush yards, out gaining Pat White. White coming off a 200-yard passing and 200-yard running game last week in the win over Pittsburgh.
But that last play showed his rookie inexperience. Bad mistake to give all that ground and lose yardage in that situation.
Third and six. Plenty of time, and Grothy throws it into the middle of the field where Amp Hill was well covered, and the Bulls have to punt.
This is where the confidence sometimes overwhelms the judgment. Two plays in a row. He gives up too much ground, so they end up with third and six instead of third and short. Protection's perfect. He's got plenty of time. He gets in a little bit of a hurry and throws it into a crowd, and now they have to punt. That's just youth.
Justin Tichy in for his fourth punt of the day. Walk-on punter and more flags.
Prior to snap. False start. Number three on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains fourth down.
Another thing to start keeping in mind here as we come toward the end of the third quarter is South Florida ran no time off the clock, essentially. They just came out and had a three and out. Didn't get much done. Neither did they turn to their deliberate kind of offense. And I know you don't want to start thinking conservatively, but it'd be a good time for South Florida to do so.
Only about 30 seconds did they run off in that last possession. Tichy's punt fielded at the 43 of West Virginia. Another flag comes down towards the end of the play. Vaughn Rivers returned it 13 yards after only a 34-yard punt. But another flag to sort out.
Legal block in the back. Number 18 on the return team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Abraham Jones, a backup safety, was the transgressor. Let's get back to Linda Cohn.
Wild game over on ESPN, Clemson, South Carolina. Will Proctor of Clemson is going to be picked off by Ethan Pepper. And James Davis will knock it out of Pepper's hands right there. It's ruled a touchback. The game is still tied. There's over 700 yards of offense between these two teams so far.
700 yards, and they still have a quarter to play in that crazy game in Clemson, South Carolina. This last penalty took away 23 yards of field position for West Virginia, and another negative play. Slayton is dropped by George Selvey.
George Selvey in pursuit, but this is a case where Slayton could have made that a 14-yard loss by reversing his field and running around. He didn't do that. He just took his medicine, got on the ground.
Third quarter is over. That's the seventh time that Slayton has been dropped for no gain or a loss. Can you believe it? West Virginia down 21-12 as we head to the fourth. Welcome back. Steve Slayton has been kept in check by the South Florida defense as the Bulls lead West Virginia 21-12 as we head to the fourth quarter in Morgantown. South Florida just 2-3 on the road this year. Look, there's a Mountaineer maniac. Can't believe it. Can't bear to watch what's going on. But West Virginia has the ball now, second and 14 from the 31. Jonas with his third sack of the day.
Jonas and George Selvey, the two defensive ends, 91 and 95 in the backfield all day long. Here's just a four across zone. Great job of coverage. Covered, covered, covered. Nobody open. At least not to the extent that White could see them. Nice job. Again, a nice defensive call at the right time.
How about a third and 19 for West Virginia? White, is he going to go down again? Yes, he is. The South Florida defense looking like the Chicago Bears. Alan Cray that time coming in. And White is not only down, but shaken up.
The offensive line for West Virginia has just really not been itself today. It hasn't blocked with its usual ability and verve in the running game. Not protecting the quarterback as well as usual. Now, you could argue he had a chance there. He had time to throw the ball. Cray coming off a blocker, and he falls awkwardly. White falls awkwardly on that left leg.
Cray at 295 pounds, tackling White, who's listed at 185, which is probably generous. Ian Randolph catches it over his shoulder. And another flag is down. Randolph picked up about 4 yards. It looks like an illegal block. Louis Gachette, number 7, was down there.
These are the things that cause coaches to develop gray hair.
Legal block in the back. Number 7 on the return team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
It was Gachette with the block in the back. West Virginia tries to figure out how to get this thing going. They're running out of time. 13:25 left to go in the game. South Florida has the ball in the lead.
South Florida defensive tackle Josh Ole Miss and his Bulls upsetting 7th-ranked West Virginia 21-12 here in the fourth quarter. Bad news as well for the Mountaineers in terms of their star quarterback, Pat White. In the first half, he sprained the top of his left foot, was just injured with his left ankle, very near the initial injury on that last series. He came to the bench, was slamming it, his hand on the bench in frustration. Rich Rodriguez came over a moment ago, very concerned as well about the status of his quarterback. We'll keep a close eye on Pat White, guys.
Thank you, Rhino. And White also has been playing with a bit of a turf toe that has been hurting him for a while. And now he has a couple of more injuries on that left foot. 4 yards on first down for Grothy. Now here's your redshirt freshman playing with a 9-point lead, 13 minutes left to go in the game. The time of possession. West Virginia not used to being down in football games. You see they trail. This aggregately, 51 minutes in the first 10 games. They've been trailing for 24-10 and counting in this one. Led it 6-0 at one point as that swing pass is caught by Pott. Now the backfield, and Ricky flies all the way up close to midfield. They're going to say that he stepped out of bounds back at the 40.
Nice job by number 78, Mark Dial here, coming out. Big fella, see? About 300 pounds. Watch him move his feet. All he's got to do is get in the way. He doesn't have to crush the guy. He does that. Then he turns around and gets another block. Nice job of lead blocking. And a little carelessness on the sideline. Otherwise, the game would have been longer.
Now coming back the other way is Cotton. And that's another first down as he gets it into West Virginia territory. Wicks makes the stop. But Ponton doing the job on the ground. This is a team that lost its number one running back, Moses Plancher, in the first game. He tore his ACL. So then they go to Benjamin Williams, who's a walk-on, still not on scholarship. And Ponton, who was suspended for the first 6 games of this season. They lost Andre Hall last year, was a great running back. And now it's been sort of a mishmash for them at running back this year. Picked up 12 in the first down on that last carry. Grothy swings it. It's another good block by Green out there as Randolph catches it. S.J. Green has had some really good blocks from the wide receiver spot as he picks up 4.
Bill Stewart is a fine quarterback coach, has done such a great job with Pat White, teaching him the basics. And this is a time when you're young, and he's still a young quarterback. You have to learn when you get in these situations against a highly aroused team and you got some injuries. You have to learn to sit down if you can't go, and you got to suck it up if you can go, and the doctors make the decision.
That was Jarrett Brown, number 16. You saw him walking around with the football. Redshirt freshman, he's the backup, got a better arm than Pat White. Worthy this time, nothing doing. As he is dropped for a 1-yard loss. Eric Wicks playing a fine game along with Johnny Dingle coming up. And 3rd and 7 is what South Florida will be facing.
This is the first time we've had what could really be called a big play in this game, Pam. But this 3rd and 7 is crucial for West Virginia. Not so much for South Florida, but West Virginia needs to get this stop. Otherwise, it's going to be first down inside their 40. And field position is one of the most important aspects in scoring points, obviously.
Yep, and it's already a 2-possession game as it is. Grothy, perfectly thrown pass to S.J. Go check that. It is number 11, Marcus Edwards. So Grothy, cool as can be, just lays it in there. First down.
West Virginia sitting back in the zone. And you see Marcus Edwards just coming across, wide open. Plenty of room for the first down, secures the football, looks it into his hands. Good, careful concentration on fundamentals by this South Florida team.
Grothy, the redshirt freshman, 1st and 10 from the 34, hangs on to it, picks up maybe a yard.
Had he pitched that ball, they might still be running. he had Potten as the trailback, and he took it to the end man on the line of scrimmage, exactly the way you're supposed to run the option. The end man turned his shoulders and committed to tackle him, and he did not pitch the ball. Here he comes down the line of scrimmage. Right here, all he's got to do is look at Potten. He's going to run this way with plenty of room to run.
Bobby Hathaway got up on Grothy in a hurry. In another split second, he probably would have pitched it. Now, second and 12, however, for the Bulls. West Virginia's only loss this year was to Louisville. Grothy again puts a hand down. He tries to crawl forward, picks up a couple. Slavonic makes the stop, a sophomore from Pittsburgh. So here's another significant third and long coming up.
And South Florida has begun to let the clock run down. South Florida has become cognizant of the time, and they're using as much as possible before they snap the ball each time.
They've already used over 4 minutes on this drive. Here's the ninth play of the drive. Grothy, time. He throws it behind his intended receiver. There's a wrestling match for it, but Randolph comes up with it. He was locked up with Quentin Andrews. And that is close to the first down marker.
Wow. All-out blitz by West Virginia. Just a really sophisticated package. You'll see it, and a marvelous pickup by the offensive line, this patchwork offensive line, as you described it, Pam. And then a poor throw, one of the few poor throws by Grothy today. Ian Randolph comes up with the football, and he sort of got there in a dead heat with Quentin Andrews. And just took the ball away from him. And it comes down to stuff that coaches talk about. Who wants it more?
It appears they're going to be about a half yard short of the first down. And indeed they are. So here you go. Fourth and about a half yard from the 24. Decision time for Jim Leavitt.
Well, if you go from 21 to 24 and the 12-point lead as opposed to the 9-point, that's not going to help you nearly as much as this first down would. So they're going to go for the first.
They're going to review the last play. We are supposing to see if the spot was correct. But Jim Leavitt does have his offensive squad out there. They are ready to go for it on fourth and about a half a yard.
Yeah, and you know, as a coach, you just think, come on, don't take our momentum. We got a little something going tonight. We got good body language. You got a good feel over here. We're hustling up the line of scrimmage. We're going to knock them back and make the first down. And this is where the measurement can actually hurt the offensive team. You lose a little bit of that zip and that pep that you feel we're going to make this first down. You got to stand for 4 or 5 minutes.
Now, looking at that replay, it looks like it was a favorable spot for West Virginia. As they are looking at what our crew is shooting. Buddy Ward has been very busy as the replay official upstairs. Last big call. They ruled originally that Ian Randolph had stepped out of bounds, but they went to the replay and they discovered that he had indeed scored on a 21-yard touchdown, and that is what has given South Florida a 21-12 lead.
The thing that's frustrating for people, and it's very frustrating for coaches, is the length of time required in situations like this. It just does not appear that it should take this long to make a decision about a line call. And again, I empathize with both coaches, but especially in the case of the offense, when everything's so precision and everything's based on rhythm, and we got a rhythm going, we got a drive going, and then you have to stand for 4 or 5 minutes.
Referee Tom Tomczyk communicating with the people upstairs. But overall, do you like the replay system?
Bill? I do. I like the replay system. I think it works. But I really, really have a problem with this kind of situation because we're just all the, I don't want to say all the energy, but the things are just oozing out of probably both teams, but especially the offensive unit. Look at Leavitt. I mean, it can't take this long.
Yeah, you wouldn't understand why if they're just looking at the spot.
No.
See the statistics rolling by. How about this statistic? Pat White and Steve Slayton combined for 435 yards on the ground last week. This week, 53. They have been totally shut down by the South Florida defense.
Well, Jim Leavitt is a defensive guy.
Based on indisputable video evidence, the ball will be placed just shy of the 23-yard line and will remeasure for a first down.
So they are going to give South Florida a little bit more real estate.
Well, you called it, Pam. You said it appeared to be a very favorable mark for West Virginia, and it's going to be marked closer to, oh, yeah, this
oh,
will
boy.
Do it.
That's a first down.
Down,
I think.
That's a first down.
And that yellow line was the electronically produced first down line.
Yeah, that yellow line is ours.
That's ours.
That does not necessarily mean they made it, but they did. They made it. I looked over there at the sideline, and you call it, Pam, that they got a very favorable spot for West Virginia, and now it's going to be first down South Florida.
Whoa.
Big time call.
Rich Rodriguez, as his team went into the locker room, they were down 14-6. This is amazing. You said Jim Leavitt's a defensive coach, but this is amazing what they've been able to do with this offense.
If you take Jim Leavitt and put Wally Burnham with him, that's dangerous. Now, those guys know something.
The drive, alive, Grothy completes it. That's another first down. Ben Busby getting it, and he is marked inside the 10, first and goal, Bulls.
Ben Busby.
Now, this was the spot before the review. About a half yard short. And then after the review, they got it. So that was one of the biggest reviews, certainly, of the season for West Virginia. This is a team that still is in the hunt for the Big East Championship and the BCS Bowl berth that comes with it. But they lose today, pretty much over. Ponton in the backfield as another flag comes down.
Blakely, number 84, the tight end.
Right of snap. False start. 84 offense.
And man,
5-yard penalty from the previous spot.
He knows it. And he's a senior. Now, that tight end, Busby, that just caught the ball for the first down, that guy's a freshman. Will Blakely comes out, and he jumps the snap count and lurches in here in what could arguably be called the most important series in the history of the USF program, because this will be that signature win against a top 10 team at their place late in the year that Jim Leavitt and his team has not been able to pull off.
And a catch by Busby, by the way, the first of his career. It was a big one for a first down. Swinging over to Edwards, and Marcus Edwards. As Eric Wicks gets up high, Edwards takes him out of bounds, picks up 8.
We've bragged about the defense, but the Rod Smith offense, the adaptation of the things that he learned from Rich Rodriguez, so impressive today. They've got an answer for everything. They're bunching it up. They're going to stop you from running it in there. They're bunching up the middle because you've been running bootlegs and curls, and so you just throw a little hitch out there, and it's 2nd and 7. It's just really, really impressive.
They've had the ball for almost 3 minutes more than West Virginia in this game. Grothy trying the left side of his offensive line, and he is stopped short of the goal line by John Holmes, one of the safeties. So here is 3rd and goal from the 2.
Now, they've lost a lot of people up front at South Florida, but watch Martin Dial, number 78, the big guy we were bragging about, Matt Huners, just knocking people back over there to the left side, and this young quarterback knows how to get his pads down and carry the football like a running back with the ball secure. You're not going to knock it loose from Grothy.
3rd and goal from the 2. 13th play of this drive. Grothy going for the touchdown. He had a man open, but it's knocked down at the line of scrimmage. Marcus Edwards open in the end zone, but Boo McClee got a hand on it.
Boo McClee very alertly This is another little quick boot. It's an unusual play, and it's very tough for a linebacker to see that coming. Look at him time his jump. Great play by Boo McClee, because it's an easy touchdown if he doesn't get a piece of it there.
He may be the most physical of the linebackers. All Big East first team last year. Delbert Alvarado in for the field goal attempt. An 18-yard try. His first of the day. Snap was a little low, but it was placed nicely, and Alvarado able to knock it home, and that extends the lead to 24-12. So the 18-yard field goal for Delbert Alvarado. West Virginia has a lot of work to do when we return.
ESPN2's College Football is presented by Pennzoil, not just oil, Pennzoil. And in part by Remington Titanium Shavers.
Spectacular day in West Virginia for late November. And the fans here not seeing what they expected. Their hometown team down 24-12. A lot of students came back early from Thanksgiving break. Classes start up again on Monday, and this guy's thinking, why did I come home early? Goodness, to see this. We actually have some people who are leaving the stadium trying to beat the rush out of here. As West Virginia has 6 minutes and 38 seconds to score at least 12 points. Vaughn Rivers, good kick returner. Can he get it going? That's nice for West Virginia as he gets it up past the 40-yard line. We get you back to Linda Cohn for an update.
Okay, Pam and Bill over on ABC. Florida State making it a game against those Gators. That's right, Lorenzo Booker taking it 34 yards. Booker's going to end up down at the one after that tremendous run. And the next play for Florida State, Joe Surratt. His first touchdown since September 23rd. It's a 7-point game. Florida still on top. And how about South Carolina now leading Clemson 31-28 over on ESPN?
Island, a crazy game in Clemson. Florida State trying to stay with Florida. Here we have West Virginia fighting for its life. Darrell Jallo with the catch. He had one way back in the first quarter, picked up 8. Pat White is out there, and he's noticeably limping on that hurt left leg.
I think it will be obvious that we'll see a lot more throwing of the football for all the reasons that we know, but also because of that wounded foot of his.
As Dave Ryan reported, he hurt his foot earlier in the game, got his leg rolled up on. But Pat White, he's a gamer. He's tough. Growthy tough on the other side, as is Pat White. Oh, that was a decisive tackle. And some more boos coming down from this crowd. Aaron Harris, a true freshman from Williston, Florida.
This is an undersized, very young, inexperienced defense for South Florida. I really thought they'd be manhandled today, and it's been just the opposite.
White gets it knocked down. You know who that was? Jarrett Bowie, the junior from Tampa, Florida. These guys have been all over the place.
But this is the kind of thing that happens. It's contagious. A defense starts playing well. George Selvey with a big play. Chris Robinson has been outstanding. Yep. He's moved from defensive end back to linebacker with a loss of St. Louis. He's made tackles all over the field, including special team. Here we come with the biggest play of the game.
4th and 1. West Virginia has to go for it. As they try to climb back in, Pat White hangs onto it, and he will indeed get the first down. Pat tackled down around the 44-yard line, needed 1 yard, got 7. Harris, a true freshman, with his 3rd stop of the game. Now here's today's sharp Aquas image of the game, and we take you back to the second quarter. And you mentioned Chris Robinson, number 49, what a big game he's had. He had the strip. George Selvey picks it in, goes in for the touchdown, and South Florida went up 7-6 and has led ever since. Flag comes down as that pass is completed to Brandon Miles.
Pam, as you know, the other thing I thought that West Virginia would do is take advantage of Trey Williams. I think their receivers can run faster than Trey Williams, and this time it looks like he's going to be called for
holding
interference.
Number 76 on the offense. Pass interference in the defense. Play is replayed.
Well, they did get the interference, but Dan Moses, the terrific center for West Virginia, called for the hold.
And you'll be able to see Williams on the back of the receiver. Just got there a little bit early. Not a real bad or flagrant interference. He's backpedaling. I think the wide receivers for West Virginia can run right by him. He obviously is confident in his speed.
Williams, 6 interceptions, leads the Big East in that category. And they have not really picked on him today, as Coach mentioned. Little pump fake for White. He's going for it all. And he is going for Miles, and he gets him. Brandon Miles beats Williams that time for the score. Brandon Miles with the second touchdown catch of the day.
Brandon Miles, in the matchup that I expected to see earlier, just runs right by Trey Williams. Williams trying to hold him up the line of scrimmage. When he escapes, Williams simply cannot run with him, and the throw is absolutely perfect.
Miles has been the big play receiver for West Virginia the last couple of years. That one was a 44-yard score. As McAfee makes it a 5-point game with 5:16 left to go. So Pat White very quickly drives his team down the final 44 yards to Miles, and they're back in it. Brandon Miles' second touchdown catch of the day makes it a 24-19 game, and Dave Ryan, things have to be different on that sideline.
And they certainly are, for the first time since about 12 o'clock Eastern. High noon when this game started. The fans are into it. The WVU bench is into it. A lot of emotion after the Brandon Miles touchdown catch from Pat White. Keep in mind, though, trainers still dealing with White's left foot, a strained foot. He's still hurting quite a bit. But, yeah, a lot of momentum finally back on the WVU sideline.
They used only a minute 22 to go 59 yards on that last drive, 44 up on the Miles for the touchdown. That whole thing set up by a 41-yard kick return by Vaughn Rivers. And now they're trying to draw up a winning play. South Florida's Taurus Johnson with the kick. Takes it to the 22. South Florida earlier this year almost beat another really good team in Rutgers. Jeremy Ito's attempt is blocked. Matt Grothy, a 16-yard touchdown pass to Ian Randolph. But on the conversion, Amp Hill will probably never forget that as he dropped it. Would have sent the game into overtime, but the Scarlet Knights hold on to win it 22-20. Can they hold on to win this one?
It's all on the defense here. And if West Virginia gangs up and plays the run, expecting conservative football, they'll get burned by Grothy, I assure you.
But Grothy goes down immediately. Johnny Dingle, number 92, wraps him up. The last time South Florida had the ball, they used 6 minutes and 47 seconds worth of clock on a field goal drive.
Jim Leavitt will not let this game get away because he was too conservative in this situation. They have an incredibly diverse offense, and they will use it here.
They got no gain on first down. Grothy now in the empty backfield. And the right tackle move, they got him. Walter Walker got up early out of his stance.
Ball start. 75 offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains second down.
Everything that South Florida does is without noise. The snap count is something that comes on the snap, and the linemen are responsible for it. They're not affected by noise because they use hand signals, and they have a noiseless count.
This is a young team. How will they deal with the pressure? Now second and 15. Changing it up. Now Grothy has to talk to his line. And he takes it right up the gut. As West Virginia was blitzing, he gets seven. So it will be third and eight. Antonio Lewis with the stop.
Yeah, and he saw what he wanted. And West Virginia showed the blitz, and they came up. And he called the quarterback draw. I thought, that's a bad call. He's going to get nailed in the backfield. It didn't happen, and he almost popped it for the first down.
Third and eight. They have to get it to the 32-yard line to keep the drive alive.
Every skilled player is getting a signal from the sideline.
Time. He has a man and overthrew him. Ian Randolph would have been a first down. He was standing at the 35, and Grothy knows he let one get away.
He let one get away because he had a Rydell on the side of his head. That was a heck of a pass rush by James Ingram. Number 95 gets there and drops him on the spot. I thought it was 95. It must have been Keelan Dykes, 96. It was one of those 90s. Anyhow, he got there in time to force the bad throw.
And now it's fourth and eight. Justin Tichy, the sophomore walk-on punter, lets it fly from around his 13. Good punt as it goes over the head of Antonio Lewis, who didn't try to catch it, and will pay for it as it takes a big South Florida roll.
Huge mistake by Lewis. Huge mistake. Got to feel that ball. You have somehow, well, he's hearing it right now from the special teams coach. You've got to bring that thing in. Now, it was an unusual punt. It's one of those that starts sailing and floating and looking funny, so you don't want to touch it. You're afraid you'll drop it. You got to have enough confidence in your hands that you bring that in. You don't give away 15 yards of field position or 12 or whatever it was because of a mistake like that.
Counted as a 61-yard punt, and it did roll at least 10 yards and some more time going off the clock as it went backwards. So 3:05 left and counting. West Virginia has all three timeouts remaining, but need a touchdown. White floats one literally, and it is caught by Slayton. It was tipped by Jonas. That's why it was a floater. Jonas has had a heck of a game.
Jonas is really playing hard. That's what they've expected of him all year. I'm really, really impressed with Steve Slayton. He makes catches that you don't expect him to make. He watched that ball in, even though it wasn't a long game.
In fact, he only picked up 1 yard. Jonas has six tackles. Time for White. Now it breaks down. And he throws it complete to the 35-yard line to Rayshon Bolden. First down, Mountaineers.
Doesn't get any better than this, folks. Nice job of pass protection. Offensive lineman scrambling for the fleet quarterback. The quarterback moving intelligently in the pocket, and a perfect throw. This is exciting.
Bolden only had 7 yards on the season coming into this game. That was a big catch, or 7 catches on the season, I should say.
Well, if you love football, this is what you live for. Moments. A determined underdog attempt.
We're going to have our fourth official review of the day. Let's see. Microphone not functioning for our referee, Tom Tomczyk. That was a 19-yard gain. And they are indeed reviewing, as they've had some problems with the equipment. 2 minutes and 13 seconds remaining, and they are going to make sure that Bolden made that catch. You be the judge.
You see the hands underneath the football, and from this angle, it would appear that he had the ball. The other bench, of course, protested immediately, saying he did not. It certainly looks like a catch. It looks like what landed was his left forearm with the ball in it.
South Florida has has challenged this.
There are a couple of reasons, a little gamesmanship that goes on at a time like this. Leavitt sees the momentum shifting completely to the home team, so he stops it for a challenge. Why not? You got the challenge. Let that offensive unit stand around for 5 minutes while it's reviewed.
Or if he loses the challenge, South Florida will lose a timeout. We really only have two looks at this one. This is one of them. And again, it has to be indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field, which was that it was a catch.
And South Florida rolls a lot of defensive linemen, but it doesn't hurt to let them stand around here and catch their breath so that they're 100% fresh to come off that football the next time it's snapped.
But it's hands and coaches' challenges this year. Coming into today, there were 153 challenges, only 26 were successful. That's only a 17% rate of overturning a call. So they do lose the timeout, and it's a first and 10 from the 35. Would have been a 3rd and 9 at the 16 had it not been ruled a catch. And West Virginia with all three of its timeouts now on the 35.
And with a rested D-line ready to come off the ball, they'll line up with their big old rear ends up in the air in sprinter stances, and you got to protect them if you're the O-line. This is where you earn your scholarship. Funny things happen with shadows this time of day. Wide receivers have difficulty. The ball comes in and out of light. It really is something to think about.
Most of the field now covered with shadows. The far sideline, pretty sunny, and he throws into the sun. That one is zipped over the head of his intended receiver, Darrell Jolla, who has a couple of catches on the day. Coming up tonight at 8 Eastern time on ABC, it's Notre Dame and USC. Pete Carroll and company looking for another spot in the BCS championship game. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines, part of Rivalry Week, presented by Remington on ABC. John David Booty against Brady Quinn, a couple of good ones tonight. 2nd and 10, White, the lefty, rolls left, puts that one up. That's a dangerous pass, and it's almost caught. Boy, Rayshon Bolden almost went up and brought it down. George Selvey was all over White, who got hit again.
This is a sprint protection that's supposed to get the quarterback outside the pocket so he's not vulnerable. Nice spin move by Selvey to get off the block, the down block that had him pinned in. He's got marvelous athletic ability. Bear in mind, he's just a freshman, the most productive defensive lineman on the South Florida team.
So much potential for the South Florida team. They're already bowl eligible this year, going to go to a bowl for the second straight time. 3rd and 10. Mountaineers. White hits again, and it's intercepted. The tipped pass goes into the hands of Trey Williams, and that might do it. South Florida gets the turnover. Joel Miss with another big hit on White.
I think that was Cray, wasn't it? Was that 94? It's hard. I think it was Cray. They had lined him up in Joel Miss's position. And he came off the edge. We'll take a look here, and we'll get a chance to see who it is. This John Figner is supposed to be blocking on him. No, by golly, you know who that is? That's none other than Chris Robinson, number 49. He's been dominating the game all day long. We didn't even know he was lining up over there. He's been playing linebacker. He's been playing in on the other side. Now he comes in for Jonas and makes the definitive hit of the day that causes the interception. Ball was just thrown too high off the receiver's fingers, and the alert Williams comes down with it.
7th interception of the season for Williams, who leads the Big East in picks. But you're right, Chris Robinson has done a heck of a job. Pressed into action at linebacker at times because Pat St. Louis went out in the first half after he hurt his right knee, and Robinson's been all over the field. And West Virginia has turned the ball over 4 times, and they're now down 5. They've taken a timeout, and just a minute 54 left to go in the ball game.
South Florida's going to have to make a first down here because West Virginia has 2 timeouts, so they can't just take a knee and run the clock out. They'll need to try to make a first down, and that means there's hope. That means West Virginia's got a chance to knock it loose, get the ball, get back down the field and score.
And some of the West Virginia fans heading for the exits. Most of them, though, are staying, hoping for close to a miracle finish. Benjamin Williams in the backfield, who gets it and backs his way up for about a half-yard gain. Eric Wicks in on the stop as West Virginia takes its second timeout. South Florida, remember that very impressive win last season where they just steamrolled Louisville in Tampa 45-14. That was their last win against a top 25 team. West Virginia is ranked 7th now.
And they're at West Virginia.
Yep, a tough, tough place to play.
You could say this is a downright Floridic day. Is that a word?
It is now. If you can say that other word, that digital word you used in the first half, you can say Floridic.
It's a Florida-like day, and that probably did help the South Florida team. West Virginia people talking about, gee, we wish it were freezing cold. Rich Rodriguez just hoping and praying for another shot to get his guys on the field, because what great teams do is they find a way to win the game, even in situations like this. If you got a great team, you find a way.
West Virginia right now can only hope, obviously, for a miracle comeback here, but they need help if they want to get that Big East championship. They need Louisville to win. They play Rutgers next week. Head-to-head, December 2nd game that will be on either ESPN or ESPN2. Now, let's assume, barring a miracle, that South Florida wins this game. This would be the way the standings look. West Virginia would fall the half game behind Louisville and Rutgers. Louisville beat West Virginia, so they have that tiebreak, and they take on Rutgers here next week. Brody throwing to Bleakley, his tight end, and Bleakley is stopped close to the first down by Quentin Andrews.
Wow. 2 series ago, we said, don't count on Leavitt to just sort of run out the clock or try to run it out. They will do something aggressive. Well, here it is again. He has so much confidence in this young quarterback that he allows him to throw the bootleg in the most critical situation of the season for their team.
Brothy, the redshirt freshman, leading the way. This is his 11th straight start, and that's a first down. And they're going to review the spot again upstairs. Boise State, they're unbeaten as they are looking for BCS berth taking on Nevada. And Wake Forest, Maryland, the winner of this game tonight, 7:45 Eastern time on ESPN and ESPN HD, gets the division championship in the ACC and will play Georgia Tech next week in the ACC championship game. So Rich Rodriguez, fit to be tied. He was unhappy at halftime with his team down, and things haven't gotten much better.
We're looking at this South Florida front group, and they've played a lot of people. Some real bad news for Big East competition. John Jumas, sophomore. Aaron Harris, number 98, who's played pretty well in stretches, freshman. George Selvey, who's dominated much of the game, freshman. Chris Robinson, who's dominated the other part of the game, freshman. Going to be seeing these folks for a long, long time, and they're already good players. They've grown up during this season because they've been thrown into the action.
So now they're going to take a look at the spot. Here it is.
The ball will be placed at the 49.5-yard line. It'll be third down.
He meant 36.5-yard line.
So that's what he meant.
Put it back about a half yard, so it is third down. Let's take a look.
See, the rule says you spot the ball where it is when the knee hits, and that's the judgment call that has to come from upstairs. And so in that case, they were correct.
Third and one as Chris Robinson looks on. He's had a heck of a ball game.
He got visions of sugar plums dancing in his head, because what a Christmas day he has given to his team. He made the big play on the kickoff return with the catching the guy by the toe. He was about to pop it for a long one.
Jim Leavitt looking on third and one. West Virginia has only one timeout left. And they give it to the running back who gets close to the first down. That's walk-on Benjamin Williams.
He's got it.
And he does indeed have the first down.
That's it.
And barring a turnover, that should indeed be it. West Virginia just with one timeout remaining.
Well, they'll have to use the timeout now to prevent the clock from starting back. The first down stops the clock. So they're using their last timeout, which is the only wise thing to do, but to no avail. They'll just take a knee now and run the clock out. Unless they miss an exchange between the center and the quarterback, South Florida will win the game.
And let's head down to the field now. Dave Ryan. Ryan.
Well, Bill and Pam, we know all about these, right? These are media guides, and usually when programs have an incredible tradition, it can take dozens of pages to wrap up their tradition and all the bowl wins. This is it for South Florida, guys. 10 seasons of college football. Not all of those have been at the 1A level. So you can see how many years they've got here. Last year was 6-6, their first ever bowl game at the 1A level for Jim Leavitt. What a job they have done in just the 10 years. Just two non-losing seasons for South Florida. An eighth win today in their first trip ever to West Virginia. The biggest win ever, I think, in the program's history against the highest ranked team, the Mountaineers, in a very tough place to play.
That does tell you something, Rhino, when there's just one page for all of their years of football. School has only been open since 1956. They started playing football in 97, joined the Big East just last year. And you might recall 3 years ago, make it 4 years ago in 2002, they were 9-2 as an independent, but they did not go to a bowl, even though they beat Oklahoma and Arkansas that year. Now they're in the Big East, and they are going to go with a win today to 8-4 on the season. And they are looking at a bowl for sure. Other games of note, look at Connecticut giving Cincinnati trouble after Cincinnati's upset win last week. Louisville and Pittsburgh play about 10 minutes from now, and Rutgers has defeated Syracuse. So Rutgers coming in here next week to take on a West Virginia team that's going to be bumming, and I think Coach Rod's going to have a spirited week of practice planned. Brophy taking the knee. South Florida, what a way to end their regular season, as they will await word on a bowl bid.
I think you're right, Pam. The coaches will coach them hard this week, but you have to be careful at this point because the BCS Bowl is down the tubes, the championship is down the tubes, and guys lose their motivation. They think you're down on them. That's a mistake. Gothy justifiably happy, and the Gatorade bath for Jim Leavitt, and certainly much deserved.
Got the blue Gatorade on him. Jim Leavitt, boy, Chris Robinson, it would be tough to pick a player of the game in this one. Have to be somebody on defense, I think, for South Florida. Grothy playing solid. And the rushing defense. How about four turnovers? They shut down Slayton and White. Let's go down to Dave Ryan.
Fresh off the Gatorade bath.
Yeah, it's cold. It's cold.
I'm sure it is. The win for your program, perhaps. Number 7 team in the nation. You've never done that. How do you react to those words?
Well, yeah, it's... It's a big win. I haven't thought about it, you know. And it's a great win for our team, certain for our program. And you know, I love Tampa and St. Pete and the whole Bay Area. And, you know, the support we get is great. It's just good.
How do you best describe this feeling, Jim?
Well, it's pretty powerful, really, because, you know, our guys played a good game. I want our guys to play well. And I told them, don't be surprised if you're not leading the fourth quarter. And just believe, you know, and have confidence.
Thanks for your time.
All right, thank you.
Pam?
Oh, thanks, Rhino. Boy, a very emotional Jim Leavitt. He's got that late November coach's voice, or lack thereof. What a game it was. South Florida upsets West Virginia 24-19. Up next on ESPN2, College Football Scoreboard presented by Acura. With Bill Curry and Dave Ryan, I'm Pam Ward. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. So long from Mountaineer Field in West Virginia.
huge win for South Florida over West Virginia, and maybe continuing to lend credence about the depth and the strength of that depth in the Big East Conference. In West Virginia, it was a long shot anyway, Mark, but they were at least on the periphery of the discussion. One-loss teams, maybe a shot at the national championship. All of that got away from them at home against the Bulls today.
And they have the talent, especially on offense. When you look at Steve Slayton and Pat White, but they didn't play well today. But what really got West Virginia was the turnovers today. Four turnovers in the game today against South Florida cost them the victory. Not only that, if you look at the big picture over the season, this is their second loss of the season. Their other loss against Louisville, they turned the ball over multiple times in that game. So this is a football team. If they protect the ball and they can run the football with their quarterback and running back, they are a tough team to beat. But it's a tough lesson to learn for two sophomore players that are the stars of this team, that you've got to protect the football at all costs if you want to win football games.
I'll tell you who else this loss really hurt. It hurt the Big East, because had West Virginia finished 10-1 or 11-1, Louisville finished 11-1, there's an excellent chance they would have had two participants in the BCS Bowl, which would have meant a huge amount of money. But by West Virginia getting beat, it now means there's only going to be one representative in it. Consequently, the Big East was a loser as well as West Virginia.
Yeah, Rutgers still has an opportunity to play its way in now, but they have to go to Morgantown and beat West Virginia if they want to get the automatic berth to the BCS from the Big East Conference.